Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, babies and citizens, this joy to the world, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, babies and citizens, this joy to the world. I bring a message of the truth amidst a world full of lies. I graduated from learning lies to see the truth, indoctrinated to be too blind to see the proof. I once was lost, but now I'm found, so I shine light. And everywhere I go is darkness, so I shine bright.
Welcome back to another action-packed, truth-packed episode of Uncommon Ground. This is episode 8. We are covering tonight the coming alien deception. And I'm joined here by my friend, as always, co-host, brother in the faith, Sean from Kingdom and Context. How are you doing tonight, brother?
I'm doing great. What's up, West Blaze? Thanks for having me on again. This episode, we get to dig into culture pop phenomenons as well as incredible deceptions that have been building for, I personally would say, thousands of years, and we're going to show some of that evidence. But I mean, tonight's a power-packed episode, so please stay to the end. And we got a special guest going to join us, so
it is, hang out with us. We got a good friend of mine joining us as well. And man, yeah, like you said, this is a topic that not only have we seen spoken about increasingly here in the last few weeks because of something we'll discuss here in a moment, but it's been discussed over the past few decades by presidents, the so-called father of the modern educational system, and even back millennia ago by ancient cultures. So I'm looking forward to getting into that. Last week, we gave away some shirts. We gave away a grand prize of an Antikythera watch. Still looking to hear back from Alexander. Look out for your emails, brother. We want to get your shirt size and address so we can get your prize back off to you. Otherwise, thank you, Miss Tracy and Rebel for reaching back to us. And we appreciate y'all. I've been blown away by the support we're getting. It's really been a blessing to me. Thank you, Sean, for wanting to do the show with me, because it seems that from the reactions, from the comments and responses we're getting a lot of feedback saying that we're really edifying and blessing and entertaining people with what we're doing. I'm great.
Yeah, this has been a blessing. I'm getting the same kind of feedback in my inbox. So, and of course, our Facebook page, Uncommon Ground, if you haven't already went and liked that, do that. If you're not actually subscribed to West Blaze Music channel that you're watching this on, make sure you subscribe to that also, so you don't hit the little bell and the notifications right beside the bell, so you can not miss any show that we do in the future, because we do these on Wednesday nights. So we're growing. We're excited.
That's right.
People are passing our episodes to family members. So that's exciting.
Showing them to children, doing some, kind of homeschool work curriculum with them as a result, brother. Also got to say how great God is that, Messenger of the Most High, my Facebook that I operate, my Facebook page, ministry page that I use, just hit 100,000 followers.
That's awesome.
On there.
That's
100,000,
awesome.
Despite the algorithms and the shadow bans and censorship. So praise the Father.
Praise Allah. Yeah, that's amazing, man. That is amazing. So, you know, tonight we've got this, do we want to have our guest on first, or do you want to play a clip real quick?
Yeah, let's play
the clip. Let's bring
up. Yeah, you had an intro.
Yeah.
Yeah, there it is. We got a little intro video for you guys. You might have caught it in the teaser for this episode, but
gives some incredible build up to our guest coming on. Here it is right here.
When I was younger, I was really intrigued with the paranormal, and I had a lot of tough questions, and Christians didn't seem to have good answers, so I went down the road of the occult, and I was like, hey, if these people are playing with Ouija boards and they're communicating with somebody out there, I want to know what that is, because Christians don't have good answers for my tough questions. So I feel like it's a Christian's duty, and specifically my duty, to find answers and have answers for these tough questions. And I want to talk about UFOs. We've been told by all the mainstream news outlets that in June, the Pentagon is going to declassify everything they know about UFOs. And so I've been looking into this topic for a long time, because I've always wanted to know what it was all about. And over the years, what I found out was not what I once believed. And so I feel like it's very important to talk about this topic.
Welcome everybody to the show from Little Light Studios, Truth to the Youth. Mikey, Jenny, everybody, you got on mute, brother. Unmute it so we can hear you. Welcome to the show, my friend.
Thank you so much for having me on, man. I didn't know you guys were going to play that clip, but that's the way I feel, man. I feel like as Christians, shouldn't we be the ones with all the answers, right? Because the Bible has the answers. And I honestly wish Christians were taking this subject more seriously.
Myself as well. Green screen looks great, brother. Welcome. Glad to have you.
Welcome, Mike. It's good to have you, brother.
Thanks, man. Thanks, John.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So tonight, we actually have a couple clips. This whole concept of aliens, West Blaze, Mikey, you know, this month of June supposedly is when they're supposed to go ahead and do an official big announcement. Congress itself has demanded disclosure about this topic, and they actually slipped that in the coronavirus back in like January. So they're hoping to get actually from the CIA, from the intelligence agencies that have dealt with this information previously. Congress is requesting they do a full disclosure and tell them exactly what they know. And basically they're going to come out and say what everyone already has been programmed to believe, which is that they're real and that they are here among us, that kind of stuff. So, but what's crazy is they've actually systematically been revealing this type of stuff with official documents and videos for the Mexican military in 2004, last year in 2020 with the Navy, US Navy pilots and things like that. So they've been like teasing this out to get people ready for a big massive disclosure about this. But we're going to actually dive into this topic biblically and also with observation and history and look at, is it truly men from another solar system? Is that what the scriptures actually give credence for or even room to believe? Or do the scriptures describe something completely different? And does history describe something completely different? So we're going to look at it.
Absolutely. We've spent the better part of the past 7 episodes that we've done here on Uncommon Ground. Anybody that hasn't seen it, go back and check out these last episodes, because most of that 14 hours or so that we've put in so far has been spent trying to show from scriptures, experimentation, real world observation, history, people that were speaking out all throughout recorded historical, you know, sources that are showing that the world, the creation, the so-called universe that God created is nothing like we've been told. And so it leads to an enclosed model where there is no terra firma planets existing somewhere out in a vacuum of infinite outer space. So that if you've grown to understand these things, and this is why it's important, this topic that we're going to be talking about tonight is important because you can see from the biblical creation model that it's a deception, that there's no other beings coming from another world out in these cosmos, other than the ones that biblically came from somewhere much different.
Yeah, that's also another very vital topic. You know, a lot of people say, does it matter? Biblical cosmology, does it really affect my salvation? This and that. But I think it's as important as understanding creation itself and not believing in the evolution model. So if you're a Christian that says, hey, we should debunk evolution, the theory of evolution, I think the biblical cosmology is as important as that. Because if you understand that, you could never fall for evolution. You could never fall for aliens and all these things unless they're fish that are trying to come in or something, you know?
Very much so. It's a big part of their evolutionary theologies and ideologies that they impose upon the masses, that this evolutionary cosmology of having evolved from, you know, a single point of a big bang, an explosion of nothingness. Like, when do we ever see nothing explode? And when it does it ever create things into order, or does it cause chaos and destruction? So just all around, we've been told lies, and these lies and these propaganda pieces that they've been forcing on us are going to build up into a grand deception that many people from history, some insiders in the space industries, have even called it their final card, the final card of deception that they have. So if you got a clip for us, Sean, I wanted to play that teaser for this episode.
Yeah, we got this. 1 second.
That'd be cool, bro. Thank you. Hell is a hot place. I don't want to go. There it is.
So the Pentagon is going to present Congress with an unclassified report on recent UFO sightings.
Newly leaked video allegedly shows one of the U.S. Navy's stealth ships tracking an unknown object in the sky.
Well, if there's a thing, it's rotating.
Once considered fodder for science fiction enthusiasts, the subject of unidentified flying objects has become a matter of national security.
Newly released radar footage clearly captures several UFOs swarming a Navy ship. The U.S. government is now acknowledging the existence of unidentified aerial phenomena. The U.S. Senate has ordered now the Director of National Intelligence and the Secretary of Defense to deliver a report on the topic.
The Corona relief bill the President signed last month contains a provision that hasn't gotten a lot of attention. It directs the Director of National Intelligence to disclose what they know about UFOs within 180 days. So what are they going to tell us?
This is going to be a very interesting year for UFOs, that's for sure, Tucker. And yes, they will definitely have to produce this report.
But what if there was some sort of outer space crisis? An alien invasion sounds crazy, perhaps.
If suddenly there was a threat to this world from some other species, from another planet.
Perhaps we need some outside universal threat to make us recognize this common bond. If we were facing an alien threat from outside this world.
If we were visited someday, I wouldn't be surprised. Maybe the only way to unite this incredibly divided world of ours if we felt threatened by a space invader.
Stoked, bro.
Crazy stuff, right? So it's becoming a reality that this is actually something they're pushing on us, and it's increasing every day that they're talking about it on the news. And I'm anxious to get into the presentation. Really, can't wait to share some.
When you hear those presidents say that the way to unite the world against an alien being, I mean, they're plainly speaking right from Revelation, dude. It's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's the funny part is a lot of the whole world doesn't realize just how there's no other religion in history that offers you the story like Genesis 11, the Tower of Babel, which gave us the division that we still have to this day. And we're going to actually talk about that when we get into the scriptures, but that's what these, you know, that's this propaganda being espoused even by a U.S. president is trying to address, which is why are we all so divided? How do we get everyone back together? Well, that's because the Father instituted that.
That's right.
And that's not going to change until the sun shows up and brings peace to the earth. So it's very interesting to see that they're actively trying to overcome what happened in Genesis 11, still thousands of years later. And this is, yeah, we'll talk about this as we delve further. In fact, you're so right, Westblaze. Not only are they pushing this propaganda on us, my whole life I've seen it, right? But in the modern age, it's getting even worse on the children because that they know that's their future audience, right? So that's why in every piece of media, cartoons, movies, and of course video games, huge into video games, you know what I mean? And in fact, one of the most popular video games for younger children is called Fortnite, and they actually have this is the new season of Fortnite, right?
Newest season just dropped this video, the whole season four just dropped like 2 days ago, right before this video here. So appropriate that they would do so.
Then the rest of them showed up.
Never before have we seen anything quite like this.
Sorry to pause real quick. What people don't realize about this commercial is them playing these notes. That's the callback to a movie back from like 1980.
Close Encounters.
Close Encounters of the Fourth Kind. So they know parents are in the room while the kids are playing this game. And that's how they're trying to get to the parents too. Kids don't understand that reference right there. That's
no, and that Rick and Morty show is not a kids children's show at all. You know, so
that's hitting our generation, that like 20 and 30 year old generation. Yeah absolutely. Nothing's free. This is play for free. Nothing's free, guys. It's taking a toll on you for sure.
Also, that new Eternals movie. Did you guys see the preview for that?
I caught that one, actually.
Yeah, so it shows a giant spaceship come, and they're there's like a dialogue about how we've been with you guys from the beginning. We've helped you advance and all this stuff, and now we're going to basically live with you. It's pretty wild, man.
Same stuff the ancient aliens is pushing.
There's a group of YouTubers that react and make skits and comedy videos about, you know, stuff like that. So they're reacting to that Eternals trailer, and the skits that they're making is, so wait a minute, if these Eternal guys have been here the whole time all the Marvel movies would happen, and why didn't they step in and stop Thanos? So like they're making funny skits about it. It's hilarious.
What's crazy is how long it actually takes to make a video game level or whatever, how long it takes to make a movie like Eternals, but yet the timing is like now. I mean, I don't think that's coincidence.
No, they've been announcing the Eternals movie for almost 3 years. Mm-hmm. And they kept saying they're going to wait till after the Infinity War saga was over to release it. So yeah, they've been, all this is very much planned. I mean, can you imagine being a fly on the wall in those meetings and seeing the big chalkboard where they're like, all right, here in fall of 2022, we're going to do this. And that's going to lead into this. And
all the phases.
Yeah, because in retrospect, it's easy for us to look back and see how things were systematically introduced to us. You know what I'm saying? We have this, especially when it comes to this topic of aliens. I mean, you guys remember the infamous story of War of the Worlds radio broadcast?
Oh, yeah.
That scared New England.
H.G. Wells or George Orwell?
H.G. Wells.
H.G. Wells.
Yeah. George Orwell wrote 1984 and Animal Farm.
Yeah.
But yeah, man, people were scared to death, literally hiding in bunkers, getting their guns, thinking that there would be. People were, killing themselves, truly thinking, and this is back in like the 40s. So that means there was enough heliglobe indoctrination to that point. And they were trying to, that was that kind of PSYOP was reinforcing the idea that something could actually come from another planet, even though that's not what the Bible describes at all. Many of you guys have already seen our previous episodes. We go into great detail, the hundreds of scriptures that describe the creation model that the Father gave us in his word. It's very detailed, and none of it has any allowance for this vast cosmology of space and everything. In fact, we're going to go over the Greek word cosmos used in Ephesians chapter 6 later. And it's very interesting how that connects to some of the topics we're talking about.
I got to be honest and say that growing up, I assumed, based on the acceptance of the creation model and this infinite universe expanding with infinite potential of other life forms and infinite other planets, I assumed it would be ignorant and arrogant to think that we were the only ones, that this so-called planet was the only one with habitable life and all of that on it. So I definitely grew up expecting that we would encounter or have already encountered a culture, a race, civilization from outside of this world. But yeah,
I think that mind shift started in our lifetime. I mean, I'm 37, but like when I was a young kid, I was kind of one of the weird ones when I believed in aliens. But over time, like me and Scotty, we went on the streets doing a on the street interview, asking people, do you believe in aliens? Dude, 98% of the people said, oh yeah, you know, of course there has to be life out there. They're just saying it's ridiculous to think there's not life. And then I said, if they had a message for us, if they had some kind of answers to world peace or whatever, would you accept it? All of them that said they believed in aliens, all of them said yes. They didn't even question like, well, maybe they're liars or maybe they're deceivers. That thought is not even coming into their mind at all.
Yeah, it's strange. It's almost part of the plan and the propaganda to get people just so confused and mistrusting of the government, to where when this other so-called authority comes, that people will just be willing to hand over their rights and their safeties and everything to that, if that's what happens, if they're literal beings that get presented to us instead of just the crafts.
I did want to bring that up. I don't know what kind of little timeline we're going on right here, so I don't want to jump the gun or anything, but I really believe that this is all a PSYOP in a way that when I would see stuff like the alien autopsy, I was like, oh yeah, I'm seeing something I'm not supposed to see. Something got leaked out and I'm seeing it. That is to make us, they want us to be the ones to say, tell us now, we want the truth, blah, blah, blah. Whereas 50 years ago, people just thought you were crazy for even believing in aliens. So they've purposely slipped out these things that we think are like, oh, it's leaked. No, it's not leaked. It's purposely released a little at a time to make you feel like you've got a hold of something special or secret. And now the people are the ones crying out, we want to know the truth.
Yeah. Or all too often, it might even just be some guy like you and me in the basement making some weird films, you know, and then and gets released. And then somebody else thinks, oh, this is from the government. And so, you know, all kinds of stuff happens like that. But Sean, what do we got? Let's get started. Let's get into
it. Well, we're wanting to show people not only are they trying to get to the kids, but they're also trying to get to the adults. And this is something else that, you know, when Trump was in office, he enacted this new concept, new branch of the military, so-called, called Space Force. And a lot of people, I actually have an extended family member works for the Air Force or is in the Air Force that is a part of Space Force. Wow. Now, are they going to space? No. They're just like all compartmentalization within military or military branches. There's, you know, they only do certain jobs that contributes to an overall concept. That doesn't mean they're actually going into space or anything like that. But they're sold on the narrative. They think that it's real. They think it's legit, right? Because they think they're working towards something that doesn't actually exist. And they don't realize it doesn't actually exist. So, but you've got very slick. And what's interesting, we're going to show a little clip here from a commercial that's going around. It's actually for Space Force. People don't realize how they're taking real images of you know, military bases and people in uniform doing their job. And then they splice it with cartoons. People don't realize they're cartoons. Really all they do.
And then keep in mind also the title of our first episode that we did of Uncommon Ground, Sky's the Limit. Keep that in mind while you're watching this.
Yes. Mm. Yeah.
Today, space is essential not only to our way of life, it's absolutely critical to the modern way of war.
No, it's not.
GPS, ATMs, cell phones, gas pumps, traffic lights, power grids, guided missiles, surveillance, RPAs, ground combat control. There's no such thing as a day without space operations.
Yes, there is.
You just don't see them. Earth is only half the battle. Cyber attacks and jamming of our satellites. Microsatellites that can create a debris field. At 17,000 miles an hour, a piece of metal the size of a coin can be weaponized.
Theoretically.
It's funny how you've never seen that actually
now
happen.
Now is the time for a military branch with a clear and singular focus on space. A military branch that protects the hopes and dreams of America and our way of life. As the space domain becomes more and more contested.
Near sun.
It's time for another giant leap.
CGI.
The United States Space Force is being built from the brightest minds across the space operations of the Earth.
Were they wearing actual, like, Orchid space Man exterminator suits?
Oh, that's like, what it looked like.
Those are the thinnest spacesuits I've ever seen. They must have some incredible technology.
Air Force, our joint services, and the private sector. We aren't just getting ready for the near future. We're getting ready for the 22nd century.
Cartoons.
When our enemies ask, what if? We will have an answer. When foreign powers can build bases on the dark side of the moon.
No, they don't.
When private companies are inventing a new economy beyond our planet, we need to stay one step ahead of the future. And the future is where we'll make history. We will fight in an environment with no up or down, or left or right, where there are no borders and nowhere to hide. Our Space Force is defending our country, here on Earth and wherever our mission takes us. As commerce and exploration expand, we will imagine the unimaginable, anticipate the inconceivable, and prepare for the impossible. We won't just think outside the box. We'll think outside the atmosphere. In one of the most challenging environments ever known.
Yes, it is.
I mean, did they actually watch our episode or something?
I don't know, right?
What in the world, man?
During the beginning of that, when he was explaining like all the things that space has to do with life or whatever, did he say cell phones? Because
yes.
Doesn't everybody know that cell phones work on cell towers? I mean, that's just like a blatant lie right in there, right? Yeah, in their script.
Yeah, the whole thing is, I agree with you. It's he did mention that, and it's just trying to reinforce that, which is you get that conversation all the time when you talk to someone about the shape of creation and what the Bible says. They'll say, bro, the fact that you're using your cell phone right now to talk to me on social media about this disproves that the world, you know, is a flat stationary plane. They think cell phones alone somehow proves the ball in space model. And you're sitting there going, bro, that's not what the word says. That's not what observation says. That's not any. And did you know that internet and cell phones are not using satellites?
Yeah, I mean, using you can cables just and landlines. How do cell phones work? Yeah. And they're going to tell you towers. It's not like we're saying, oh no, they work this way, and it's a conspiracy theory. No, that's really how it works. That's what you can find out on your on your own.
Ground-based positioning system. Absolutely. Real quick, yeah. I was just looking up because I think it's Latin. Like the is it the Marines that has the Semper Fidelis, it's, always faithful?
It's a fraternity. It's a fraternity. Yeah.
So they had Semper Supra, which is always, and then supra is defined as used in academic or legal text to refer to someone or something mentioned above or earlier. Semper supra. Weird. Something so like a super. Always something keep, mentioned earlier. I don't know.
Keep in mind that as we go through the rest of the information, because that's going to matter. Also, did you guys realize, by the way, I love music, right? And specifically, I like scores of soundtracks of movies. And that music is a ripoff of this Inception soundtrack.
Oh, wow.
So it's at a different key, but it's the same orchestral progression. And it towards like the last minute of that commercial, it's the Inception soundtrack, even to the point of, I'm gonna put this on screen real quick. This is the actual the end of the movie Inception.
Yeah.
So the end of the, here, I'll that the end of that file that we just watched, that that commercial the we commercial, just watched.
Right. I remember how the music sounded, but I don't know about this Inception.
Watch this. So this part here at the very end, listen to the sound. Forget about what you're seeing.
Yeah.
All right. Did you hear that? Uh-huh, all right. Uh-huh. Guys, this not only is the actual score of that commercial a ripoff of Inception, that last little part there with the high pitched and the way it stops, that's actually the end, the very end of Inception. Wow. So Inception, of course, is an entire movie about a special elite group of people that were supposed to be able to go into your brain and implant a thought in your head.
Wow.
So here is here is the end of the movie Inception, and I'm going to try to see if I can, 1 second. Let me try this again and make sure the sound's on.
It's just mockery. Just plain.
It truly is.
Rubbing it in our face.
Yeah. I don't know if you can hear it or not.
I can hear.
So the idea with this little thing he's spinning, if the thing falls, he's in the real life. He's in the real world. But if it never falls, the little top he spun, then he's still in a dream. It's still That's Inception. Right. So at the end of the movie, the thing never falls and the camera stops, but listen to the sound.
Yep.
It's the exact same thing.
Like the piano or string.
And even how the words came on screen, dude. Good catch, bro.
Yeah. They're literally mocking people because they're putting in your brain a thought that shouldn't be there, that your brain wants to naturally reject, which is this whole idea that we're going to be fighting aliens in space and that all of it's real and that they can somehow have propulsion and have lasers and defend their satellites that are supposed to be 20,000 of them up there that never seem to fall, like all this kind of stuff.
Or against those asteroids that never seem to hit.
Right.
So to see them fall and crash into the ground.
That's exactly what I believe. I've seen some news clips recently where they show like the Earth and they show this CG eye of an asteroid coming really close. And all they're doing is they're creating a justification for creating weapons toward heaven. They're creating, we got to have this nuke to blast an asteroid. And so we're all like, yeah, please protect us. And we know that somebody is coming to Earth and that all the world wants to fight against, Satan has deceived everybody to want to fight against Christ.
Good call, brother. That's exactly what I think about all of it too, which is why I was texting Westblaze a few days ago as we were talking about our notes for the show. And I was like, yeah, man, this could be some of the very minute details about the beast and everything and about the 10 kings of the earth giving their power to the beast for 1 hour. And then, of course, they all assemble their armies to go fight Yeshua's return. Mm-hmm. I mean, it could very easily be done with the narrative of we're the good aliens. The bad ones are on their way. We need to go help. We need your help. All of us come together to ward off these bad aliens. So I'm actually going to go over some scriptures that might give credibility to that about how a first encounter happened and they lose. And then they have to gather all the forces of the earth to try to fight Yeshua's actual second coming. It's a theory, but we're going to talk about the scriptures that would support that kind of theory. So, but actually, we actually have some scriptures to review about this topic in general.
Excellent. You want to join us in reading some of these, Mikey? I'll take this first one. Cool. Okay. This is Jubilees 10, verse 22, and it says, "And the Lord our God said unto us, Behold, they are one people, and this they begin to do, and now nothing will be withholden from them. Go to, let us go down and confound their language, that they may not understand one another's speech, and they may be dispersed into cities and nations, and one purpose will no longer abide with them till the day of judgment."
Wow. Yeah, that's a parallel to something in Genesis. And I just think it's amazing that God himself said, when all humanity comes together, there's nothing they can't do. Nothing. I mean, like when people say, well, you know, I don't think God will let it get to the point where you're transhuman and all this stuff. No, God is so patient and long suffering that it's going to get pretty weird and crazy. And yeah, God's saying there's nothing we can't do. And we've reached a time now where we have translators on the internet. I can talk with anyone around the world. I'm talking to you guys right now where you're at. I mean, it's like we're hanging out in real life together right now. And even if you guys were speaking another language, there's technology that could translate what you're saying and I could see it. And if we were, you know, crazy scientists, we could be having a, you know, we could be talking about how we're going to create some crazy technology right now.
Yeah, true.
Yeah, I actually, since 2011, I asked my roommate that in 2011. I said, what? Because I was reading the Bible, talking to him about it. They're both believers. And I said, hey, I was like, Chris, what? I just had a weird thought. Like, if God dispersed everybody who spoke one language, like if he broke up their languages and that's how he stopped them from rebellion, well, because I just found out about this Google Translator earpiece that they had just released that was like $2,000, could translate 50 of the world's most popular languages. And it's like an enhanced technology from what translators in the United Nations building have been using for a long time. But it can do 50 languages and not just one. So I thought, like, what happens if we do have, through technology, the ability to all talk easily again, no matter what nation you're in? I was like, would that be a problem for the Father? Since he obviously instituted Genesis 11's events, and he didn't want us to be able to communicate like that easily again. What happens when we can? Well, guys, I don't know how you feel about this, but to me, the end of this verse tells us exactly what happened. Like, they're not going to abide as one nation and under one purpose until the day of judgment. What do we see in Revelation on the day of judgment when he returns? They've all come together again.
Yeah.
It's making me think of like the United Nations logo. And we know that that is pretty accurate map, but it's almost like United Nations, like they're just stamping their name. Like this is our name, is just in complete defiance to God.
Yeah. Right.
One world basically is what the name is.
What's so crazy is that the Father doesn't obviously want to divide us for the sake of division.
Yeah.
He probably wouldn't have got mad if all the countries had come together and actually done proper behavior, but that's not why they all came together. That all the nations came together to actually go out and outright rebellion against him and try to get through the firmament. And literally ignore. I mean, yeah. Anyway, I could.
Well, that's what it says, and it's like they came together, and this is what they do. You know,
right? Mm-hmm. Instead of they came together and they got better at teaching each other how to serve me and how to walk in love with me. Instead of that, they came together to go against me and embolden each other to go against me. And I actually read a quote in one of my Kingdom Cast episodes from Josephus, and he actually talked about this as well, about how Nimrod was the one that incited them into an incremental forms of oppression through government, and simultaneously was teaching the people that it was bravery to go against the Creator, and it was cowardice to believe and trust in the Creator. So like it was the origins of Babylon, obviously. So that's the same theology that we're still dealing with today, is people think it's brave that we come together as a one world so that we can protect ourselves against foreign threats that are out there.
And we still hear it as esteemed as cowardice to believe that the Bible is literally true.
Yeah,
we do. What are we going to say, Mikey?
I was just going to say there's some other lifestyles that go completely against God as well. That's considered brave. You know, Caitlyn Jenner got the award of bravery and all this stuff.
It's Pride Month right now.
Something to be prideful about, right? Pride goes before the fall. Pride goes before destruction.
So there's another concept in Scripture that, while this doesn't have specific language about an event, a people, or a place, it's kind of more philosophical ideal that the Father's trying to tell us, hey, look, guys, you know, don't be surprised when you see cyclical patterns in this world, you know, and this is what we see here. Ecclesiastes chapter 1, 9 through 11. Mikey, do you want to read this one?
Yeah, it says, what has been will be again, and what has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. Is there a case where one can say, look, this is new? It has already existed in the ages before us. There is no remembrance of those who came before, and those yet to come will not be remembered by those who follow after. Wow. Yeah, that's deep. Yeah, it's like in this generation, we don't remember when there was a time like this, but we see this kind of stuff all the time. Like, you know, when you're in high school, your parents are like, oh, we were wearing that same stuff when we were in high school, but we didn't see that. So to us, it's new and cool or whatever.
Yeah. History repeats itself, right? Man, yeah. The author of Ecclesiastes was really fond of the phrase under the sun, wasn't he? Mm-hmm. I searched that phrase. It's in there like 20, 30 times almost. He's and he's just painting a picture there that everything under the sun, because the sun is above the plane of the earth. Yeah.
Under the sun.
Literal so directional terms.
We're actually going to talk about in Ephesians 6, there's a term I'm going to show you guys later. It's called sublunar, and it means everything under the moon.
Yeah.
Oh, nice. So yeah, it's pretty interesting. But so here in Ephesians 6, 10 through 12, it says, finally be strong in the Lord and his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can make your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers. And that word in the Greek is the word cosmic powers. And against the authorities and against the powers of this world's darkness and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. So guys, literally in the Greek, this word cosmos kratios is this word for cosmic powers, which loosely translates to rulers in the English. But if we look at the Strong's Concordance, it's the Greek, you know, number 2188 or 2888. Cosmos kratos, crater, is a ruler of this world. But if you go down to the definition, it's the ruler of this world, also as a world as asserting its independence of God. Specifically, the connotation of this term in Greek is not that you're just a ruler of this world, because we know that King David was, you know, or the angels themselves have been appointed to watch over the world, and they're considered rulers in Scripture. No, this specific word is about people in rebellion against God.
Oh, wow.
And it says it's used of angelic or demonic powers controlling the sublunary world, which means everything beneath the moon, the terra firma beneath the moon. That's hilarious to me.
It is. It is interesting. Okay, yeah. I like it.
Isn't that crazy?
A ruler of this world, and Satan is called just that.
Yes, and that's where if you go further breakdown of this word, cosmos creator, it actually specifically says referring to Satan and demons influencing the lives of worldly people.
So are you implying that when people talk about the cosmos, that it came from this Greek word that means satanic?
I think I even said it earlier. Now I know better. Yeah.
There's another word that sounds probably more accurate, universe, which is two words. One spoken word or whatever.
Yeah. So here in Ephesians, Paul is encouraging the Ephesians that became converts to Yeshua and believers. He's trying to express to them, like, we're not battling flesh and blood, guys. We're battling literally, you know, rebellious angels and demons. And specifically, he referenced them with the word, which is the Greek word, the only use of the word cosmos.
Yeah.
Wow. That's really interesting. That's new to me.
Yeah, he ends the verse even by saying that they're in heavenly places. Other versions say in high places.
Yeah.
How interesting. Looking forward to hearing more about that.
We'll be talking about that in greater depth later.
We will. Absolutely.
Yeah, so that's it's crazy, right? I mean, that is right there in the text. We just obviously missed some of it. Some of it gets lost in translation coming from Greek to English over the years. But Westplays, do you want the next verse?
Sure, thank you. Matthew 24, verse 29. Christ says, this is Christ speaking, right? Yeah. For false Christs and false prophets will appear and perform great signs and wonders that would deceive even the elect if it were possible. See, I have told you in advance. It's a warning. I'm telling you this in advance to look out for it, because false Christs, false prophets, messengers will appear, and they're even going to perform things like miracles that we would perceive them as false wonders and signs.
Yeah. I've been interested in this topic my entire life, and over the years I've bought documentaries and stuff that are not from a Christian stance at all. They're just UFO conventions and things like that, and people are telling their testimony of when they got abducted, and it's really weird to hear some of their stories, because sometimes they describe stuff that I would never even consider alien at all anyway. Like, I've seen drawings of like a black shadowy figure with horns and red eyes, and it's like, you sure that's an alien? And,
bro, wait till I say some stuff later.
Okay. Yeah. And people talk about, you know, they're being sucked straight out of the roof or straight out of the window, and these things can go through walls and stuff. But what's interesting is when they ask about the message is always about how Christ isn't who you think he is, and we need to get rid of religious dogma, and that's what's wrong with the world, that they've been watching us for a long time, and they're trying to give us a message to help us, and it's always about this religious divide. Yeah. But the only divisive religion is Christianity, because we believe it's the truth, the only truth, and you can't really have a coexistence with that belief, that's that mindset. Right.
The truth does divide. Absolutely. Yep. So that last verse where he says that even the elect would be deceived if possible. Do we have another verse that says?
Yeah. And I just want to say real quick, this idea of, you know, someone that's performing signs and wonders, what is a Christ? The word Christ is this idea of the anointed one, the Messiah, which is also means the anointed one. And these are fake. These aren't real, but they come as acting like they're trying to be real. What is promised of the Christ when he shows up? Well, he tells people everywhere he goes in the Gospels, when he's like, yeah, go heal. Like he tells his disciples in Luke 9 and Matthew 10, they go out and heal the people and tell them, when you do that, tell them that the gospel of the kingdom or the kingdom of God has come upon you. So this is why when Yeshua would heal people, he'd say that, you know, the kingdom of God is at hand. It's near. It's come upon you. Mm-hmm. Because he's telling these people what we're going to experience when the Messiah actually comes to the earth and reigns, and all the kings submit to him in reverence, and there's peace, and there's no more war, he's going to heal everybody of every disease. So this is why he was going around healing people constantly and telling you the kingdom of God's come upon you. He's telling them, this is what it's going to be like. So when a fake Messiah shows up, he's also going to promise healing. And we're going to show you that here in a little bit. We also hear that in a lot of the testimonies of quote-unquote UFO abductees, is they always, like, I heard this really in-depth long one time, that this guy was healed of cancer, and they literally gave the quote-unquote aliens literally gave him his cancer in a jar back to him.
Wow.
They pulled it out of his body, the dead tissue, dead cells, put it into a jar, and he had it, took it to doctors, got verified he was cured of cancer, and they tested what was in the jar, and it was cancerous skin tissue with his matching DNA.
Wow.
Right. So, yeah, because he had previously been diagnosed with cancer. So, like, there's all these amazing stories that's being built into the populace about the, you know, these saviors, these alien saviors that show up and be able to help us with problems that we have on the earth.
Yeah, because I was just thinking, it's not physical healing just of disease. They're also going to come with solutions to economic and financial problems, I'm sure.
Climate change, all that nonsense. Yeah, they're going to come with all of it.
So why I mentioned what their message always is because this verse is telling us false prophets. You know, if somebody comes and tells you I have some kind of truth for you, that's the false prophets. And there's another verse, I don't know if you're going to bring it up, but it might even be right around that area, I'm not sure the reference, but it talks about that some will that they'll fall from the faith or whatever, being seduced by doctrines of demons. This is talking about believers, you know. So yeah, that says that if it were possible, even the very elect. I think that number, that idea of the elect, a lot of people just say, well, I believe in Jesus, I'm part of the elect. I think it's a lot smaller than that, because a lot of people believe in Jesus. There's New Age that believe in Jesus. The Mormons believe in Jesus. You know, which Jesus do you believe in? And that elect, you know, Revelation calls it a remnant. I believe that it's much smaller than we think. And if we are not grounded on the truth, then we could be deceived. Just like those people that says that they turned from the faith or whatever. I can't remember how it's worded, but it says that they turned from the faith believing in doctrines of devils. So they were in the faith, but they fell for the lie.
Very true.
Yeah.
Yep. And the falling away, apostasia. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So slightly switch gears here. And Mikey, if your turn, if you want to read this one, Revelation 12, 7 through 9.
Yeah. Then a war broke out in heaven. It's highlighted heaven there. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, which is Satan, and the dragon and his angels fought back. But the dragon was not strong enough, and no longer was any place found in heaven for him and his angels. And the great dragon was hurled down, that ancient serpent called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the world, of the whole world. He was hurled to the earth, and his angels with him.
He's this deceiver of what? Just a little bit of the world?
The whole world.
Oh.
That's got to be a great deception, man.
Yeah. Is it multiple worlds? Just one world?
When I hear this and I'm thinking, I'm like, man, there's a lot of... How can you deceive the whole world? There's an atheist out there. There's Hindus and Jews and all these different belief systems. What would it take to deceive the whole world? I think Reagan had it right.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing that would bring them all together would be deceiving them, apparently.
That's right. Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, Revelation does talk about Satan deceiving a number like the sand of the sea, and he's uniting them in a battle. So,
yeah, and that's, we also wanted to just point out real quick, we've already discussed this definition of this word heaven. It's the actual name in Genesis 1:6-8, the name that was given to this structure of creation called the firmament. So this is where we're going to actually go over some other verses in First Enoch and kind of expound on this idea. I know that there's a lot of different believers out there that have their own understanding of when they think that this passage takes place.
Mm-hmm.
Regardless of when you think it takes place.
And who these characters are.
Yeah, we're just going to kind of dive into like where technically is it taking place according to the definition Scripture give us, and then who are the people involved. We can have another show and really dissect the when at a different time, because there's flexibility in my understanding of when it could happen. But the word heaven has a very specific definition in the Greek. It's aronos in the rakia in the Hebrew. So like this is a very specific word. And the rakia then was given this word shomayim, which is translated into heaven.
The sky water.
And that was the name given to the structure, the rakia that was created. The six layers that were created on day one, and then the last seventh layer that encompasses us that was created on day two. And so this says there's a war that broke out in heaven. Which one is that? Which of those seven layers is it talking about?
I would say under the first one.
Under the first one.
In the space where the birds fly.
You know, yeah, I was just saying, what would lead us to that conclusion, though? This is where I hope the viewer can kind of follow what we're doing here.
Well,
is Satan, what would you say? So if were we coming at a disadvantage with the modern American canon of 66 is that it doesn't tell you the origins of Satan. It doesn't tell you where he came from, nor does it tell you the origins of those who are considered his helpers, his messengers. So that's actually what some of the words that we want to break down real quick. And it's also going to help us, once we figure out what those words are, it's going to help us figure out the better positioning, if you will, of in this firmament creation model, where's this battle actually taking place? So this is where, if you look in the Strong's 3772 in the Greek, this is the word aronos, which means heaven. And it can be used for multiple uses. It can be the visible heavens, the atmosphere, the sky, the starry heavens, and the spiritual heavens. So I think Westblaze and I think because of our previous episodes, we would define the spiritual heavens as the first six layers that were created on day one, whereas everything else is considered the visible heaven or the atmosphere where the birds fly, like Genesis 1:19-20 expounds upon. So that's going to be the encompassing layer over us. So basically everything above the ground in Hebrew, like in Job 37:18 and a place in Psalms, refers to as the place where the birds fly. As a place that's considered the heavens as well, mm-hmm. because it's above the firmament, it's above the ground. So because now you're below, so to speak,
above the ground. Yeah.
Yeah. It's below the firmament, above the ground. There it's is. In the elevation, if you will, where you are truly encapsulated by the actual dome, by the firmament itself, but mm-hmm. you're not above in the other layers that are described in other places, because everything that was created from the earth, from the ground in days 2 through 6 was created to live under where we are in this particular layer. So we're going to go into some other verses that just expound upon that in just a minute. But what's interesting here is this word angels. And this is another word a lot of people just glaze right over, because in the Greek, this is a very vague, it's not a specific word. Mm-hmm. It's Strong's 32. It means agalos. And it can be used generally as a supernatural messenger, but also it can be used as a human messenger. And also it can be considered of as unclean spirits. Like, so this is where we dig deeper into this breakdown of this Greek word agalos, and it says properly it's a messenger or a delegate. It's either human, and it gives all the verses right here in this this lexicon to break down all the places it's used as a human messenger. John the Baptist is actually referred to as agalos in the Greek, And then it goes in to say, or it could be a celestial angel or someone sent by God to proclaim his message. It's used 176 times in the New Testament as heavenly angels, but the context determines whether a human or a celestial message is intended. And it goes on to say it can refer to a human messenger as John the Baptist or spiritual beings. So does Satan have humans that are with him that are going to be thrown down to the earth?
Does he?
Are you asking me? I believe if you follow Satan, you're going to have the same fate as him.
I mean, sure. I just mean like in this passage we looked at, it's saying there's a war. Sorry, Mike.
I learned a lot on this show, but I would say no, he doesn't have humans.
Right, because we're told later in Revelation chapter 13 through 17 that Satan gives his authority to this first beast character. Mm-hmm. And then there's a second beast character as well. Both of the first and second beast have the authority of the dragon to go out and to deceive people, to force them to take the mark, to go and make war against the nations, to persecute the saints. And then the kings of the earth, who collectively represent mankind, give their authority to the first beast, not to Satan. Mm-hmm. So therefore, we would conclude who's actually fighting with Satan in this moment. Because if we dig into, which we will here in a minute, we're going to dig into the origins of where did Satan and unclean spirits even come from. It's not humans, and it's specifically they're told they can't go above the heaven. They can't go exist in the heavens.
Yeah, no.
They're limited to this place where we are, and it tells us directly that, you know, Satan was given authority over these unclean spirits to do his temptation and his bidding. So therefore, I know the common narrative in a lot of Christian churches is that this moment here, this battle is between Satan and a bunch of other rebellious angels. So,
right.
But Peter and Jude both tell us that the angels that rebelled were chained in darkness until the day of judgment.
So who are you saying the battle is with, though?
All I'm trying to say is this passage right here that says the angels is a very generic word.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm thinking this is very possible that this could be speaking of the unclean spirits that are given to him under his control and authority, which would be the things that Jesus had to deal with, that all the nations have been dealing with for a long time, these unclean spirits, which I'm actually going to theorize are the aliens that we've been deceived upon us.
I believe that.
So this is where I'm saying we're currently, as we discuss this topic of aliens, and you can see on the slide and on my screen behind me, what is this craft with the light shooting out of it?
This is part of the depiction of a UFO, a UAP, right?
Unidentified. A wheel within a wheel, or a fiery chariot or something.
And where do these things fly?
In the heavens.
In our heavens.
That's right.
The space below the firmament.
So is it possible that this passage is actually referring to, because we're going to go over this in greater depth as we keep going, guys. So if you're still watching, just stick with us. We're not even, in my opinion, we're not even to the juicy stuff yet.
Right.
So like, because I think Westblaze and Mikey and I all agree that these are not aliens. They're not little green men from other planets. Mm-hmm. They're not, you know, some, you know, ancient Martian progenitors that seeded Earth. None of that nonsense. Yeah. They're literally demonic spirits that have, in my opinion, been working with some of the nations of the Earth for a long time in order to have the ability to get back into the game, just as they used to be a long time ago, being worshipped as false gods. So this is where I think this deception is going, so that Yeshua's words will be fulfilled when he says, when he returns, it'll be like the days of Noah. Mm-hmm. Well, during the days of Noah, you had these unclean spirits running everywhere and controlling the nations. They were called Nephilim.
Mm-hmm.
So this is where understanding the story of the Nephilim really matters when it comes to this alien deception.
They were worshipped as gods by humanity anyway, right?
Yeah, exactly right. And after the flood, yeah.
A lot of people look at these aliens as gods, especially the New Age movement.
Right. That's right. So that's why I paired up this next verse. This is, in case people aren't familiar, Isaiah 24 is all about the day of the Lord, the day that Yeshua the Messiah returns to the firmament with his angels to fight the kings of the earth, take out the first and second beast, and lock up Satan. This is all about that day. And at the end of that passage, at the end of that chapter, in verses 21 through 23, it says, "And in that day, the Lord will punish the host of heaven." Guys, what's the word host that we see used in
usually in reference to angels?
Mm-hmm.
And also for armies.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes, that's right. It says, "In that day, the Lord will punish the host of heaven above and the kings of the earth below."
Hmm.
So we've got two different things happening.
Right.
Yeah.
He says, they will be gathered together like prisoners in a pit. They will be confined to a dungeon and punished after many days. The moon will be confounded. The sun will be ashamed. This is stuff we talked about last week. For the Lord of hosts will reign on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem and before his elders with great glory.
Hallelujah.
So, yeah, this is, and this, of course, if you read, you know, the rest of that chapter, the earth is being broken up and there's a whole bunch, you know, massive earthquake, destruction. People are fleeing in terror, trying to get away from the armies of the Lord that are coming. Specifically, the host of heaven, me personally, this would translate to me in the context that I'm reading it as the armies of heaven that are actually trying to fight him at his return. So this is why, if to me, this would match up with Revelation 12. I don't know how you guys feel about it, but if I see Satan and his angels are fighting Michael and other angels, who's the messengers? Who's the people with Satan fighting? Well, to me, it would be the host of heaven that's about to be punished because they don't win that battle.
What do you think that means? The moon will be confounded and the sun will be ashamed.
We talked about a lot of that last episode in the greater light. So it's talking about the day that when, well, we see it happen at the fourth trumpet, and then also on the day of its coming, that the sun and the moon diminished in light. Yeah, they get darkened, turned to sackcloth. The moon will not give her light. Things like that.
So that's kind of a reference to, this is a, like, if end times event. Well, it's the day of the Lord, of course, but I think it makes sense to fit with Revelation.
Cool. Yeah, bro, there's so much prophecy right throughout the prophets that like Isaiah, Zechariah, they talk so much about these end time events and give greater understanding to what Revelation is saying. It's beautiful.
I think last week we even theorized that since the occult have always worshiped the sun, moon, and stars, it's kind of fitting that those luminaries are diminished at his return.
Right. Just like how when in Egypt, they worship frog gods, and then God made it rain frogs.
Frogs came up. Yeah. Yeah. It's crazy.
But they were splattering everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So here's a passage from First Enoch that we got here. And I'll
West
read
Place,
it.
Do you want this?
Yeah. Yes, I'd be glad to. So First Enoch 15:8-11, it says, and now the giants who were produced from the spirits and flesh, because flesh and flesh, if any man and any woman go out there and make a baby, it's not going to be a giant, unfortunately, in the way that these giants were. But flesh and spirit came together, and these giants shall be called evil spirits upon the earth, and on the earth shall be their dwelling. Evil spirits have proceeded from their bodies because they are born from men and from the holy watchers. Daniel talks about the watchers. Is their beginning and primal origin. So the origin of the evil spirits came from the daughters of men and holy watchers. They shall be evil spirits on the earth, and evil spirits shall they be called. As for the spirits of heaven, in heaven shall be their dwelling. But as for the spirits of the earth, which were born upon the earth, on the earth shall be their dwelling. And the spirits of the giants afflict, oppress, destroy, attack, do battle, and work destruction on the earth, and cause trouble. They take no food, but nevertheless hunger and thirst, and cause offenses. And these spirits shall rise up against the children of men and against the women, because they have proceeded from them.
Yeah, it says that as for the spirits of heaven, in heaven shall be their dwelling. They're actually dwelling up there, and we see verses about, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities in the heavenly places, wickedness in the heavenly places. This is a parallel here.
Sure. Yeah. He was in reference to spirits that were created in heaven. They the angels, right? The brotherhood. Yeah. And
this is a small passage. There's like a couple chapters of expounding in this area of Enoch. Yeah.
Yeah. So what was it saying? Just that the angels and the, you know, everything created in heaven, get the cherubim, seraphim, they were all created to stay there. That's why Jude talks about the angels that left their first estate, that abandoned their proper abode. And so then you have spirits that were created, evil spirits created on earth. Earth is their dwelling because they cannot ascend through the firmament. They're unclean.
That's right.
They can't go into the heavens.
And it says that they're causing all kinds of trouble. Like Goliath would be a good example, I guess, you know.
Yeah, they caused lots of destruction everywhere they went.
So what this passage is, this is pre-flood, this passage, right? And this is an explanation of what we see from Genesis 6:1-4, because in previous parts of First Enoch, chapters 8, 9 through 15, it actually expounds upon, you know, the rebellious watchers, that 200 of them took wives, had children, and now their children were produced from them were called the giants. And that it expounds, and that the angels that actually took wives, they got punished. They're the ones Jude refers to that are being kept in chains of darkness. Azazel was an angel that was in, grouped in with them, but he actually didn't get punished in the same way. He was not chained up. He didn't, right. and it doesn't say that he took a wife,
right?
And that's had kids.
Roaming the earth like a lion ready to devour. So
he did, because the Father's just, right? He gives people what they deserve. Well, these specific angels that took wives, the Father called that such a great transgression because they were not appointed wives and they were supposed to not because the offspring that they procreated became these abominations, these giants.
Yes.
That even after they died in the flood and lost their bodies, their spirits were still on the earth. And that's what we actually see later expounded upon both in Enoch and in Jubilees, where Noah's even praying, I need help with all these unclean spirits everywhere, like Father help. And so this is what we see happening everywhere in the Gospels. Yeshua's taking out unclean spirits left and right, kicking them out of people, because that's where they came from. They were the disembodied spirits of the giants from before the flood, and they've been around this whole time to tempt, to oppress, to attack, to destroy, you know what I'm saying, to do all the things it mentions at the end here. And this is why, here's the difference though. There were giants after the flood, and we tried to go into greater detail in previous episodes about this. They weren't created in the same fashion. And this is where the angels that did this were locked away. And none of the scriptures ever tell us another group of angels came down and made more giants. But there's other ways to make giants. Mm-hmm. Just through genetic manipulation, through modifying your DNA. And actually, it's a lot easier than people think. We actually have expounded on it in multiple episodes, just on my channel and also on a little bit here on Uncommon Ground. But it's really just all about growth hormones. And it's not as complicated as people think to actually modify someone to make them extremely tall and bigger and stronger and actually be proportionate to where their joints can handle it. So we actually, there was an entire TED Talk by epigeneticist in 2011 I watched, and she went into great depth about how there's a part of your DNA that you can affect with chemicals, specifically growth hormones. It's like a switch. Yeah. And if you turn the switch off, my body will tell my brain, my body, my chemicals will tell me to stop growing at 5'10", right, which is my height.
Like what they're doing with the messenger RNA, trying to make right. people sterile and stuff. So.
But if you figure out the right combination of these hormones and you turn that switch on, or you turn off one of the way, but you flip that switch, your body will keep growing. And so this is where it can become a huge problem mm-hmm. because of just the natural logistics of resources and, you know, food and everything that's involved. And so this is how you can literally manipulate and create giants after the flood without having angels involved.
Right. Take a little bit of tree roots, cut them up, maybe a little bit of witchcraft, but
exactly. It's a part of the pharmakia. So that's why before the flood, these particular giants that were now called unclean spirits on the earth is a very specific reason to focus on this in the storyline, because they still are here. And until the latter chapters of Enoch, the Messiah, when he returns, they're then taken off the earth and destroyed in the lake of fire. So they're not, you know, they're not still tempting mankind. They're not under the authority of Satan anymore. So that's why, in the meantime, that's why Satan shows up to Yeshua and tempts him. And Yeshua has to deal with all these unclean spirits everywhere he goes. Yep. Those are the spiritual wickedness and forces of darkness that he has to deal with specifically. So there's no other mention of other angels that rebelled out of the millions and hundreds of millions of angels mentioned in scripture. And there's no other mention of any other disembodied giants becoming unclean spirits other than that first crew that came through the flood and were under the authority of Satan to try to tempt the nations afterwards. So therefore we have like the enemy in our understanding, the enemy is named in scripture and given specifically told to us, right? So this is where, if there's a battle happening in the sky, in my understanding, literally just Satan and demons, just like Satan's a real character. And this is the part, Mikey, I think you totally agree with this idea I'm about to say, but I think you've probably run into people that struggle with this idea where they really struggle to put a sense of concreteness to angels.
Physicality.
You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. They think they're like somehow ethereal, but not really concrete or tangible. Like
just be ghosts.
Yeah, like they're not Caspers, right? They're like, mm-hmm. Look, when they show up, you might not even recognize them. Look just like you and me. You could hug one and not know it. Like their bodies can become solid, but that just like Yeshua and his resurrected body, he can have Thomas touch his side, but then he can just disappear in Luke 24 and the walk to Emmaus, you know, and they break bread or he can ascend to heaven. Like he has the capability of angels to appear, to manifest in reality, to disappear, to defy, you know, the downward force of electromagnetism, have mastery over the creation. This is the promise of the resurrection that Yeshua is the first fruits of. And so I think it's interesting that we don't have, like, Satan himself is an angel.
Yeah.
That means you could actually handshake with him.
Mm-hmm. He can actually eat.
He can actually eat food. Yeah. When it says in the temptations that he took Yeshua to the top of the temple, how do you think that happened? Do you think him and Yeshua just did some free climbing that day? They just broke out some powder and just started climbing?
Yeah, he basically abducted him and took him to the mountain.
Right? And the temple.
Well, we know spirit beings can literally teleport, go from one place, translate from one place to another.
Yeah, and maybe use some kind of vehicles. I mean, we do hear about chariots of fire and things. And when you were talking about that this was happening in our heavens, like Michael and his angels and all that, I'm thinking, is that basically like some kind of intergalactic UFOs fighting in the sky or whatever? Is that what it appeared like? What we would think is, oh wow, I just saw like 20 UFOs fighting up there, and in reality it's angelic.
They're getting a butt whooping by the angels. Yeah,
they can appear in different forms. If I could, I know we don't have a slide for this, but the testament of Reuben chapter 5 in verse 5 through 7 says, flee therefore fornication, my children, command your wives and your daughters that they adorn not their heads and faces to deceive the mind, because every woman who uses these wiles hath been reserved for eternal punishment. For thus they allured the watchers who were before the flood, for as these continually behold them, they lusted after them, and they conceived the act in their mind, for they changed themselves into the shape of men. So their angels can shapeshift.
It also says that in 1st Enoch 19 that they can assume any form they desire. You're right. It's funny. We got a funny comment, guys. Deep Holes in the crowd. He said, I'm not shaking hands with Satan, by the way. No, we're not suggesting that. We're just saying, like, that's how real possible angels are, guys. Yeah. They're tangible. Real people. They're real entities they broke Peter out of jail. Like, they can literally do stuff. They can touch and affect things. And that's how they're going to come back, and they're going to take a real chain and wrap it around a real Satan character and put him in a hole in the ground for 1,000 years. They're going to come back, and they're going to physically fight people trying to fight them. That's the story in the scriptures about how real angels are. So yeah, I'm not saying you should shake hands with him. I'm just saying, like, you know,
another example of a shape shifting is the serpent. You know, he came in as a serpent. Also, the Bible talks about that you might entertain angels unaware, not because they're invisible watching. I believe it's because that stranger that's asking for money on the side of the street could very well be an angel.
Mikey, I think you'd really enjoy the book of Tobit when you get a chance. Tobit is cool because the whole time he's the son of Tobit, I think it's Tobias, is walking with this guy that's come to help him on this mission. And then he finds out at the end, oh, it was Raphael the whole time.
Wow. Yeah. That's cool.
They're together for like 2 weeks, camping out, traveling. Yeah.
And the story of Lot with Sodom and Gomorrah, the angels went in and the people clearly saw them and wanted to have sex with them, homosexual sex with these angelic beings.
That's how real you are when you got a decent form that gay men want to hook up with you. That's how real you are. Yeah. So it's crazy, man.
I hope you guys give me the privilege to hop back on. I might need to step away for like 7 to 10 minutes to.
Yeah, absolutely.
Somebody bed. That's okay. Yeah.
You're welcome to just turn the camera off and or whatever you got to do, brother. We'll be here waiting on you.
Come on back. So yeah, that's we got one more verse real quick because I mean we could probably extend this part of the conversation a really long time, but
I bet that's
okay. But we got a lot more to get to. So really though, this is Revelation 1:7, and this is just something that I would encourage everyone that's watching. Hopefully you understand that. Hopefully you're not going to be deceived when you do see something in the sky and the government's telling you that, oh, these guys are going to come help us. They're going to come help solve our problems. We should forge alliances with them. You should be okay with them being here, no matter how strange they may look or whatever. Because Yeshua's not coming back in any type of craft.
No.
Yeshua is coming back on a white horse with a bunch of angels through the firmament. And it's not going to be him. Every eye will see him when he comes back, guys. This is going to be something where the kings of the earth got to introduce him on CNN. This isn't going to be like that.
There's so much that happens in the events following up, you know, up to it that are just going to be unmistakable. Right. Those seven trumpet judgments have worldwide catastrophic events that will not be missed. Unavoidable. That's right.
Yeah. It says every eye will see him. He's coming with the clouds. So we're going to be talking about these quote unquote UAPs, unidentified aerial phenomenons. Culturally, we refer to them as unidentified flying objects, but this is their crafts that fly in the clouds of some sorts, right? Yeshua is not coming in some metal shiny craft flying in the crowd. He's going to be coming back on a horse, and it's going to be a really dark day. It's going to be lots of battles, lots of problems happening that he's going to come stop all that stuff. And it says all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Why? Because they're going to have to stand judgment before him. And, you know,
that's unfortunately, the day that it all becomes a reality. They're like, oh,
yeah, wow. The people that are still alive will be mourning, not because some may be mad at him, but because many of those peoples that were from those nations and tribes left to go fight him and the angels. So there's going to be a lot of widows that day. Unfortunately, yeah. It's the sad reality. This is why our Heavenly Father, his eternal law is all about taking care of the widows and orphans, because that's going to be the number one priority when he shows up on the earth with his kingdom. Is there's going to be millions of orphans and widows that day that he's going to be taking care of. It's going to be the greatest example of Torah ever. So yeah, I just hope people understand that this verse, I know sometimes we've heard this verse before. It's one of the biggest, easiest ways to discern the alien deception is the opposite of the Yeshua's appearance.
Yeah.
It's crazy, man, right?
We do a lot of laughing, a lot of joking, but man, there's so much just when you can think about it in ways that it can make you sad, because there's so much deception. There's so many people that will be deceived and left cursed as a result, but based on their own behaviors, their own choice and where they place their faith. And we gotta share the truth. So that's why we're doing shows like this, to get the message out there that, hey, lies are abundant and they're going to continue to come. And so be aware, please don't be deceived.
Yeah, we have Lisa Mendez in the audience. She's saying that India, the nation of people, believe in UFOs deeply. They teach it to their peoples. Well, there's a reason why, and we're going to go over a lot of that information tonight.
Just in a minute. Yep.
Yeah, there's definitely a reason why they would.
I can read this. Oh, what
would you literally? I'm sorry. Go ahead. Yeah. This is the same verse. I just tried to make a meme of it. You know,
that's right. Yeah, it looks good, brother. You did
just well. To show people that his return will not be unidentified. You'll know exactly who's coming back.
Yeah, you'll feel it.
But speaking of ancient India, there's a lot to review. Actually, before we get into some of this, West Blaze, I think we wanted to let's look at a couple things that are going on.
Which one?
In our culture. We want to look at the church that's teaching aliens to kids in their Bible studies.
Yeah.
We want to look at that real quick.
Well, that was something Mikey had that he knew a little bit more about. So,
okay, so we wait till he gets back.
Let's wait till he gets back on that one. Maybe play a clip?
Yeah. Let's play this. It's kind of
Carol
funny,
Rosen? Actually. Oh, which one? Yeah. Okay, the Pope one?
Yeah. Guys, apparently the Pope wants to baptize aliens
I'm sure that if an emissary came here from a culture advanced enough to traverse our solar system, land on our planet, and communicate with humans, the very first thing it would do would be to seek out the man with the funniest hat.
How interesting,
and ask him
huh?
For a head bath.
Yeah.
Yeah, how interesting. He mentions the hat.
The Dagon fish hat thing, right? That's Mitre.
Crazy. That's crazy. Funny, so guys, this is something that, I mean, we're just trying to put some humor in this a little bit, but obviously this idea of aliens, I mean, for the last 70, 80 years has just been nonstop every year pushed with every form of media you can imagine, comic books, magazines, movies, TV, everything you can imagine, guys, literal government agencies talking about it. I mean, they've got what the government agency called SETI, the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. I believe that's where they have all the telescopes and everything, and they're pointing them at space, and supposedly they're just pointing them at the firmament. But
like in the movie Contact, Jodie Foster,
like Contact, yeah, that's right. So they have millions and millions of dollars going towards the propaganda that all this alien stuff is real. But guys, we want to try to share some ideas with you from history tonight that hopefully will help you understand this is nothing new under the sun. This is actually repackaged, just like we've said on this show and also on my channel. NASA, their whole theology, their whole view and teachings of the heliocentric cosmology is repackaged from ancient India and specifically from Vishnu and some of the multiverse and cosmic belief sets that was propagated by Vishnu and Brahma from ancient India. So another unique parallel with ancient India are these ideas of vimanas. And what a lot of people don't realize is that Vimanas are what we're seeing in the sky when people take home video and when clips are being released by the news. In ancient Sanskrit, Vimana means measuring out and to traversing. Basically a craft that goes forward, right? Mm-hmm. The Bodh professor of Sanskrit in Oxford University in England in 1890 translated the word Vimana as the chariot of the gods. But we're not talking about the god of heaven and earth.
No.
We're talking about other gods, Nephilim gods. So it goes on to say, this is some of the writing of ancient India, specifically in the Bhagavad Gita Marata, I think is what it's called, speaking about different types of Vimanas, what they called flying craft of the gods. The Pushpaka Vimana was a gigantic plane the size of a large city, entirely capable of holding unlimited numbers of people, as stated by Professor D.K. Kanjalal's observations of the Matsya Purana, which is one of their Vedic texts, their religious texts. So guys, this is telling you that they had massive, what did we see West plays in movies like Independence Day?
Yeah. I mean, so many of them.
Big plane that could be an entire city by itself.
That would fill up the entire camera angle view of the sky, you know, at least. So yeah, made massive city size craft. And as big as this creation is, it would not, I wouldn't put it past the elite to have something like that hidden.
That's right. And they go on to expound about what these things were, how they worked. There's an incredible amount of information in ancient Sanskrit that details who flew them, how they were used for war, how they controlled people, how they were given to the gods. And so right here, it says in Sanskrit in the Samaranganana Sutradhara, I don't think I said that right.
You did pretty good.
It's an ancient Vedic text. And it says, it's written that the strong and durable must the body of the Vana be made like a great flying bird of light material. Inside, one must put the mercury engine with its iron heating apparatus underneath. By means of the power latent in the mercury, which sets the driving whirlwind in motion. The mercury engine sets the driving whirlwind in motion. What do we see from all these UFO sightings? That these planes or these craft that are moving through the clouds are usually spinning. I got a picture.
Yeah. Okay. I got
later.
You.
Yeah.
And it's reminiscent also of like when Ezekiel is caught up into the heaven. It's like a fake of that. Like
Yeah. So he goes on to say, driving a whirlwind in motion, a man sitting inside may travel a great distance in the sky. The movements of the Vimana are such that it can vertically ascend and vertically descend. And moving slanting forwards, these descriptions are incredible. Moving slanting forwards and backward, with the help of the machines, human beings can fly in the air and heavenly beings can come down to earth.
All right.
Interesting.
Huh? How old would you say this? Like
these texts are supposed to be 3,000 to 4,000 years old.
Have mercy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Long before modern invention of electricity, right?
Right. We're talking Tower of Babel days, guys. Mm-hmm. So at Rama's, here's another quote from some of the writings. At Rama's behest, the magnificent chariot rose up to a mountain of of cloud with a tremendous din. That word din means like a tremendous blast of, you know, power.
Okay.
Another passage reads, the Bhima flew with his Vimana on an enormous ray, which was as brilliant as the sun and made a noise like the thunder of a storm.
Like a ray of light?
It sounds like a rocket blast, right? He flew fire, a ray.
Mm-hmm.
So these are just a few descriptions. It goes on to say in another passage, according to the Dronaparva, part of the Mahabharata and the Ramayana, one Vimana described was shaped like this, like a sphere, and it borne along at great speed on a mighty wind generated by Mercury. And that also is referred to as Quicksilver. Mercury is also known in history as Quicksilver.
The wind generated by it.
Wow. Right. It's telling you that it has propulsion according to this Mercury. We're going to go into that in a minute and how NASA uses it. I'm actually going to show you guys later NASA's, when the actual ion propulsion Mercury engine that NASA invented in the 70s and gave to the Smithsonian. I got a picture of it.
Okay.
So it goes on to say, in the Laws of the Babylonians, which is this particular book that was written in Mesopotamia in Sanskrit. I'm going to go over the history of that in just a minute because a lot of people are going, wait a minute. I thought the Babylonians were in Mesopotamia and the Indians were in India. What's going on here? Just give me a minute. I'll explain. In the Laws of the Babylonians, written in Sanskrit, part of the passage of the Hakata, it unambiguously states that the privilege of operating a flying machine is great. The knowledge of flight is among the most ancient of our inheritances, a gift from those upon high. We received it from them as a means of saving many lives.
No
guys, what have we been talking about? about the false Christs that would appear. What's the world been prepping through all these movies with aliens, that there's good aliens that are going to come help us to fight off the bad aliens?
And what is a Christ? A savior.
A savior.
Saving many lives. So wild.
It's crazy, guys. So this is ancient Babylonian depictions of vimanas used by Babylonian rulers in Mesopotamia. They're everywhere. They're literally sitting in one of these saucer-shaped crafts in the sky.
Hmm.
So it goes on to say, a lot of people may be asking, Wes, right, but wait, Sean, how can, I thought Sanskrit was an ancient Indian language. Why are the Babylonians in Mesopotamia talking about it? Well, PhD Indian philosophy,
Peter Sahata,
he actually is a historian as well, and he explains that during the mid-second millennial, which is 1500 BCE, this is probably during the days of Joshua, Indo-Aryan tribes migrated both east into India and west into northern Mesopotamia. And through an Indo-Aryan wedge, as new waves of Indo-European migrants came down into present-day Iran, the earlier wave was wedged apart. Those who went west became sort of a ruling elite of the Hurrian people to form a powerful Mitanni kingdom. The evidence for this is seen in a treaty between the Mitanni and the Hittites. The Hittites? Well, that sounds biblical.
It sure does.
Sounds like the Amorites and the Hittites that lived in right next to Iran in Assyria. Like, yeah. Okay, so anyway, I'm being a little facetious, guys. Just... the point is, all these tribes and cultures work together. The Bible is super relevant. This is the people that the Israelites were dealing with that were worshiping false gods. Those false gods and their rulers had crafts that they actually flew in the sky to perpetrate deception and power over their peoples. This is why they received worship as gods. This is why the God of the Bible was so intent on telling the Israelites, hey, don't believe all that. They're not real gods. They had deceptive signs and wonders even back then. So it goes on to say that the Mitanni Sanskrit is considered to be a slightly more archaic form of Sanskrit than the Vedic Sanskrit. Sadly, these people seem to have got lost in subsequent history, but thankfully, those who went to India are keeping this tradition alive. So here's an Indian philosophy history PhD telling you that, yes, these two cultures, the Babylonians and the Indians, had intermingled all the way back to 3,500 years ago. And Mikey is back with us.
What's up, Mikey? Thank you for rejoining us, brother.
Thank you for having me back, guys. Sorry about
that. No worries. And anybody who has not seen, I would highly recommend the entire series. If you go to Kingdom Cast, that's Sean's backup channel. He's got a whole series called Investigating Babylon. There was a episode of that called Flying Machines, of the Ancient Flying Machines, something along that effect. That is an amazing breakdown of more detailed presentation of what he was just talking about.
Giving you snippets right now. We're actually getting a little bit deeper into the India history about this with the Vimanas. But if you go check out that series, I go over the Greeks, the Egyptians, the Sumerians, the Akkadians, all those guys, because they all had the same tech. They all had this. They all shared the same theology. They just had different names for it because they spoke different languages after the after the tower. So it's the same deception perpetrated on every nation. That's why they all worshipped a version of Baal. Here's the point. The Indologist William Clarendon, so another Indian researcher and expert of ancient India, he says he has written down a detailed description of the Mercury Vortex Engine in his translation of the Samaranga Sutra Dhara, and he quotes this: inside the circular airframe of this craft, where the engine is, place the Mercury engine with its solar mercury boiler at the aircraft center. By means of the power latent in the heated mercury, which sets the driving whirlwind in motion, a man sitting inside may travel a great distance in a most marvelous manner. Four strong mercury containers must be built into the Vimana. The Vimana develops thunder power through the mercury.
Oh yeah, they're building these things right now behind our backs.
Oh yeah,
they have been
thunder power.
Yeah, this is...
if they have this much detail, like, that's all they need. Like, okay, we can figure
this out. Yeah, well, you guys remember that specifically Hitler took a whole group of SS to ancient Tibet and ancient India in the 30s, specifically seeking out the information of the Aryans, which they believe were the gods. Yeah. And this was how those guys traveled around. This is what we talked about in my Kingdom Cast episode about the Bell Project, the Nazi Bell Project. Yeah. So this here, it goes on to say, according to... this is going to be a tough word. I'm going to try it, though. According, this is another text from the Vimanaka Sutra. It goes on to say, according to the Rahasya Ginahadi Hakarai Sutra number two,
very good.
The pilot, it's talking about the pilot of Vimanas. The pilot is one who knows the secrets. There were 32 secrets the pilot needed to learn from the competent preceptors, and only such a person was fit to be entrusted with an airplane, and no others. There are 32 secrets of the working of the Vimana. He must know the structure of the aeroplane, know the means of its takeoff and ascent to the sky, know how to drive it, and know how to halt it when necessary, how to maneuver it and make it perform spectacular feats in the sky without crashing. Those secrets are given in the Rahashya Laha. And this, I have a citation at the very bottom here. It's from this quote is from the Aeronautical Society of India in present day by G.R. Joycer, International Academy of Sanskrit Research from 1973.
Wow. And Mikey, while you were gone, we were discussing that these concepts come from ancient India in that area from 3,000 to 4,000 years ago. They had these flying machines. Yes, bro. Yes.
So it goes on to say in that same path, I can't repeat the words, but in that same place I just quoted from, that same text, it goes on to say this. This is a specific maneuver one of those pilots had to know how to do. And it's called the Gudha. As explained in the Vayatatavava Prakarana, I totally messed that up. I'm sorry. If anyone's out there from India, I'm so sorry. It says, by harnessing the powers, the Yasa, the Vyasa, the Prayayasa, in the eighth atmospheric layer covering the earth, to attract the dark content of the solar ray and use it to hide the Vimana from the enemy.
Bruh.
Guys.
Stealth technology.
Guys, what are we looking at? This is the official Navy photo released to the United States of the UAP, the Unidentified Aerial Phenomenon.
Blacked
the
out.
UFO. It's blacked out. How many of these have we seen where they're blacked out? And you wonder, why are they blacked out? Why can't I get any description of them? Why can't I see?
There's no details in it, right? Yeah. It takes the dark content of the solar ray, like dark matter.
It's manipulating. You know how in the, it's manipulating the different types of light within solar light.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because it's putting off some kind of glow, it looks like.
This is just one maneuver. I'm going to get to another one where it makes it shine. You guys ready?
Yeah.
It's
like names for anime attacks. Go ahead.
Yeah, literally. This is the Drashiya. This means to be unseen. It, by collision of the electric power and the wind power in the atmosphere, a glow is created whose reflection is to be caught in the Vishwa Kriyadrapana, or it's a mirror at the front of the Vimana. And by its manipulation, they can make that shine, that glow, as camouflage over the Vimana.
Yeah, because it's not blacked out there. It's whited out. And that is, we see that in
we see that all the time.
Videos. Yep,
all these horror videos of people catching these glowing orbs going through the sky at crazy speeds, of defying left, right, up, down, defying physics, supposedly. They're glowing. You can't get a bead on them, even with modern good cameras. They literally have their own version of stealth camouflage, black and or glowing. This is an ancient technique from ancient Vedic texts.
That's wild.
Nothing new under the sun, guys. There's nothing new. This is why they don't want anyone to know history. They have to teach all these watered down versions. They spend how many years teaching you about the American Civil War and the American Revolution and the War of 1812? But how many times did you learn about ancient India culture and history of the gods?
Or 4,000-year-old flying machines? It would completely contradict their narrative.
So here's some glowing orbs.
Mm-hmm. Bright white lights.
Here's some glowing orbs. This is not Starlink, guys. This was taken in 2013. Oh, they're gone. Oh, it's back.
Nope. Oh, that one's up.
Two of them are just chilling. One's hanging out, and they're all going to start moving once they get information of some sort. Oh, it's going to get even crazier, guys. Stick with us if you're still watching right now. Looks like we had like 140 people watching active. Well, there's more than that watching. There's 140 people in the chat.
Cool.
So, guys, if you like what we're talking about and this is entertaining or exciting or interesting to you, hit that thumbs up. So
subscribe, share with the family and the friends. We appreciate you, each and every one of you. Thank you.
Guys, this is nothing new under the sun. This is ancient Vimana technology that we're seeing in modern time. Here's another clip that was released from an actual, I can't remember when this one was released, November 2014.
There it is.
From a helicopter pilot who saw this UFO, this UAP, and it started producing smoke out the back of it. Okay. So this is an actual move recorded for those pilots in the ancient texts. And this is the Stadbach move, which means by projecting a pasmara, which is a poisonous fume, smoke through the tube on the north side of the Vimana and discharging it with Stambana Yantra. I don't know what that means. People in enemy planes will be made unconscious.
What?
Oh.
So basically, look, if you have a craft trying to approach you, well, you just expel this outside of your craft, and when they get to that area to try to chase you, their craft is going to fly through that smoke and make them unconscious, and they'll crash.
No way. Weapons of wild proportions.
This is so there's the Vimana or the UAP, and there's the smoke that comes out of it.
Very well could be.
This wasn't a UFO that was crashing. This UFO was stationary, being filmed by this military helicopter pilot. And then in this video, you see the smoke start to come out on the back of it and then envelop it.
Mm-hmm.
And they were like, what is that? What is it doing? And it wasn't damaged. It's not, it maintained flight.
It's because they were taking a picture of it from in the air too.
Oh, and we're going to get to that too. Watch this. We're going to get to that.
All right.
I don't have a picture of this, but this is another move from one of those that these ancient pilots were taught how to fly these Vimanas. This is the Chapla. It says, on sighting an enemy plane, by turning the switch in the force center in the middle section of the Vimana, at 4,087 revolutions an hour, atmospheric wave speed will be generated and shake up the enemy plane.
Whoa.
This is a Yurukin. This is one plane to another shooting an energy blast.
A Hadouken?
Yeah. A Hadouken. I said the wrong word.
Yeah.
This is crazy. That's absolutely crazy.
Kamehameha.
Here's another move, the Parashabda Grahaka. And this one is explained in the Saudamani Kala. It's another subset of the text. The science of electronics by means of the sound capturing yantra inside the Vimana to hear the talks and the sounds inside enemy planes flying in the sky.
Wow.
So if you go up here, these Vimanas in ancient times being filmed, like if this is a Vimana that we're seeing being filmed by this military helicopter, and that Vimana has the ability to receive the sound from enemy craft because they know these ancient techniques, then they know they got them in their sights and they're filming them. Yeah. And then they may start to approach them, right? Mm-hmm. So they turn on the poisonous fumes.
Mm. Wow.
It's crazy, guys. It's crazy. Yeah. All right, you guys ready?
This is writings from the 70s, right?
You want me to take one slide for you, brother?
No, brother. This is writings from 3,000-4,000-year-old Vedic texts written in ancient Sanskrit.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, this isn't science fiction from the 70s. This is from ancient India.
Wow.
Yeah, I apologize. You were out when we kind of jumped into this segment. So, but ultimately, from what we seen described about these Vimanas and how they were powered by these Mercury engines, did you guys know that NASA developed their own ion propulsion Mercury engine?
I assumed that they would if they could.
Yeah. And so just in case you guys didn't know that, let me back up a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
On my Kingdom Cast show, I talked about how in the 1980s, there was a NASA researcher that declared if they wanted to actually accomplish AI, they needed to use Sanskrit as the language for programming, because that was what's going to make them accomplish that.
It was
that
a language without context, they said.
A language without context that could specifically be translated into AI code.
Wow.
So here's NASA also stealing ancient Hindu theology and aircraft designs, and they're even about to steal their propulsion engine. You ready?
Go ahead.
The way this is described is it impulses and generated in 7 stages. The mercury propellant is first vaporized, fed into the thruster discharge chamber, ionized and converted into plasma by a combination with electrons broken down and electrically, and then accelerated through small openings in a screen to pass out of the engine at velocities between 1,200 to 3,000 kilometers per minute, or in terms Americans would understand, 745 to 1,800 miles per minute.
That would absolutely explain what these crafts in modern times have been explained to be able to do, the physics of them.
Guys, if you've ever stood, you know, I mean, if you've ever seen, you know, a jet going speed of sound that's 700-800 miles an hour, like it's gone. Like you see it coming, you hear it coming, it's gone.
Mm-hmm.
These are going minimum twice that speed with this mercury ion propulsion engine that NASA was developing based off of ancient Vimanas from ancient India. Here's the picture of it.
Rocket motor, ion thruster, mercury bombardment type, 8-centimeter SERT, National Air and Space
Smithsonian. So when people are seeing these things, do you think it's a combination of physical technology and spiritual? Or, I mean, because I thought a lot of the stuff that defied physics had to have been spiritual. Like, how can something travel so fast and not break the sound barrier? How can you make a 90-degree turn? How can you split into two, come off and on radar, and all these things?
While you were gone, one of the writings that we read said that they received the information of how to fly, how to build these crafts from on high, from the gods, quote unquote, gods.
Yeah. So this is what the Book of Enoch talks about. Well, again, why I've said so many videos, and tonight it's so important to understand where Satan came from, where the unclean spirits came from. Before the flood, these rebellious watchers, Satan included, 200 of them took wives. Apparently Satan didn't, but all the rebellious watchers engaged in other types of rebellion, and collectively they taught mankind the secrets of heaven that men were striving to learn. They taught them all types of advanced concepts that they weren't supposed to know. So it makes perfect sense that here post-flood, you've got the ancient Indians, the ancient Sumerians, Babylonians, Greeks, Egyptians, all talking about getting their information from the quote-unquote gods. So this is even in modern day, and you know, I don't have any clips of this because it's so fringe. I'm trying to stay with stuff anyone can validate, okay?
Right.
But there's fringe testimony of people in the Washington University holding seances deep underground below Washington University.
The CERN stuff? Or
they're taking DMT trips to talk with entities in other dimensions.
Bro, that's such a common thing. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
The point is, they're trying to get information from them to build higher tech.
Yeah.
So there's literally university approved and elite approved experimentation when people are taking high doses of hallucinogens to speak with spiritual entities to get practical, real information to make higher technology.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It sounds absolutely crazy, but it's like when people are doing DMT, Joe Rogan and all this stuff, and they're saying, hey, we're communicating with something intelligent. Who else would want that except the government, right? Let's study it and try to see if there's something to this.
And even when I see people on my friends list or whatever talking about, you know, having done DMT or doing it with their friends, they're often bringing up the idea of speaking to entities like Metatron and all kinds of wild stuff.
Yeah, we have a Joe Bugle in the crowd. What's up, Joe? He's saying they can cover one side of the firmament to the other in minutes at the speeds that we just talked about. Oh, yes, they can. And in fact, we've got video of it. You guys want to watch a couple quick little videos? So this is someone, you guys remember what we talked about, okay? That the Vimanas, according to the ancient texts, the pilots were taught 32 special secrets, which is basically part of their training for flight. And some of those, they had to know how to stop the craft, raise it up and down, move fast. Also, these tricks about actually encountering enemies, camouflage themselves, you know, attack the enemy in certain ways.
Poison gas
even, right? So here is this right here. This is triangle UFOs, and that's the shape of the Vimanas. Also triangles. I'm going to go over that in a minute.
Has that same glow, that same technique with the light.
So watch this, guys. I'm not going to go through the whole video. We'll cut to about right here. And watch what happens. This is just some random dude filming up.
Whoa. That was nuts.
Yeah.
Whoever's filming this is like, you can tell he's like maneuvering to try to keep it in focus, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's about to do something crazy, right? And it's exactly what we just read, guys. How these Mercury engines can create this type of thrust. Ion propulsion.
I would be shook as well.
Yeah.
Here it goes.
What's it going to do?
You think it's going to disappear? Starts to shine.
Oh!
Who was that? Was that from the audio of the video? Or
that was the random guy that was filming it.
He said, "Oh, wow, wild, wow, man."
Yeah. Another quick clip, real quick. This guy is. This is actually this famous NBC report that came out, and they're interviewing a couple different people. One of them is a retired Navy pilot who saw a tic-tac UFO up close. Okay, and by the way, I didn't have time to put all the information in these slides. Saucer shapes, triangle shapes, like we read earlier, the gigantic planes, bell shapes, pyramid shapes, entire building shapes, which is more akin to like a large bell shape, where you could fit like a community of people on one of these vimanas and fly slowly like a blimp. And then also tic-tac shapes. They call them cigars. And specifically, in the, again, I don't have time to go through all the writings. There's thousands of pages of ancient Indian writings that detail this. And they, some of them even talk about the Asvians, which is their word translated from the Atlanteans, who had their own flying ships, which they called a cigar shape, which is like a tic-tac. Right? So check this out, guys. This is crazy.
There's a whole fleet of them. Look on the SA. My gosh.
These three videos released by the Department of Defense have changed the way many people see what we can't explain.
The moment you mention UFO, immediately what comes to mind are little green men, tinfoil hats. That's not at all what we're dealing with.
In 2004, off the coast of California, an F-18 Super Hornet training exercise was suddenly interrupted by a call over the radio that would come to define Commander David Fravor's career.
You know, there's certain things in your life where you just remember in vivid detail what happened. And that's one of them, because it's honestly the strangest, most obscure thing I've ever seen flying.
Fravor, the commanding officer of the Navy Strike Fighter Squadron 41 and another F-18 scrambled to check out an unusual radar blip 80 miles off the coast.
Fisheye lens.
So as we're looking around, the backseater in the other airplane comes up and says, "Hey, Skipper, do you see?" And before he says it, I'm like, "Dude, do you see that?" As soon as we look down, we see the whitewater, and then we see this little white tic-tac. It's pointing north-south, and it's just going forward, back, left, right.
It's just bouncing around?
Yeah, like a ping pong ball.
What was its shape? What was its... what did it look like it was made out of?
Like a perfectly smooth, white tic-tac. Or for people that...
Because that's actually one of the descriptions in the ancient text that I was reading about, is that the craft... They talk about the vimanas were made with precision detail, to where they were, the metals were pieced together and perfectly smooth. Mm-hmm. So we're not talking about, no seams. I mean, very, very high level. And in fact, there's an entire science I found and discovered last week, putting some of these notes together that I didn't know about previous. I've known about a lot of this stuff previously because I've been putting together my Investigate Babylon series, but apparently there's an entire science called powder metallurgy, where they take powders of metal, not the raw materials of metal, and smelt them down and reshape them, but they take powder of aluminum and then forge that into metal. And supposedly it's like rust proof and super smooth, more aerodynamic. And apparently there's even another type of glass that can be molded into becoming completely camouflaged, where you can't see the craft at all.
Wow.
So I mean, I'll let it keep going, but there's so much in the ancient texts that talk about these things that we're seeing in modern times.
Need a bigger visualization, a giant propane tank.
Fravor says the F-18s began circling, Fravor at 20,000 feet, and the so-called tic-tac only about 50 feet above the surface of the water.
And I say, "Hey, I'm going to go check this thing out." And the other pilot stays and says, "Hey, I'm going to stay up high." And then it starts coming up at us. We call it two-circle fight, but it's coming up, I'm coming down. So it literally is aware we're there. There's no doubt.
Almost like it heard them.
So here it is. I cut across, and I get to about half mile of it. You know, so I'm about halfway across the circle. As it gets in front of me, it just goes poof, and it's gone. And it's gone like that fast.
What do you mean, poof, it's gone?
I mean exactly that. Like, it's 1 minute there, and the next second, it's like magic trick. So I asked the other airplane, I said, "Hey, do you guys see that?" And they're like, "It's gone. It just disappeared."
When you saw this kind of performance, what was the first thing that went through your mind?
What the hell was that?
So guys, pardon my interruption to this real quick. There's just a few more minutes of this, but some of the other techniques of the pilots that I didn't get and just put on the screen tonight, because I just had too much time and I didn't have any visuals to show. But one of the other techniques, in addition to being able to hear inside the enemy craft to hear what they're talking about, there was another technique supposedly allowed you to view remotely what the pilots were doing inside enemy craft.
Whoa. I mean, nothing surprises me now, like after hearing, and it's just wild. Like, we think, we're often told that this technology, that the physics that they're performing, it can't be created on Earth. But the ancient, you know, Vedic and Indian texts were just telling you, like, the mercury engines, they were telling you all the elements and things that they used to literally make them from Earth.
So when not only is remote viewing a big thing the government's been studying for about 40 years now, but I mean, this is occultic stuff, guys. This is not, I mean, it is technology, but at the same time, again, it's given by the Watchers, which it's the occult. It's used for the occult. It also talked, the reason why I'm mentioning that is because this guy being interviewed on screen right here, this particular NBC clip doesn't show his full interview. And it's in the full interview, it explains that when this thing disappeared, this tic-tac-shaped UAP they saw disappeared, and they flew the F-18 Hornets he and his squadron were piloting, they flew to another destination like 10 miles away. The tic-tac met them there. So that would make perfect sense if they could hear what they're talking about and somehow see
the readouts inside, and know where they're going.
Their readout, know their coordinates. And then it would, and of course, it has superior speed, so it just flies there to meet. He's just playing with them.
Yeah.
The testimonies just kind of lined up with exactly what we're reading. So very interesting.
Crazy, guys.
This is fascinating. I hope this is a highly viewed episode.
Favors team told the next crew what had happened, and that crew took off ready to capture something on camera. And this is what they saw.
I guess the biggest question is, what do you think it is?
I honestly don't know. I don't think that we have developed that technology. I don't think we developed it on this planet. We still, to this day, have no idea what it was, what we saw, what we chased, what we engaged. But it was pretty spectacular.
A report from that incident eventually made its way to the Pentagon and crossed the desk of Luis Elizondo, the former director of the Advanced Aerospace Threat Identification Program.
In essence, what that program was an investigatory body looking at the what we call the UAP, probably in the vernacular, it's better known as the UFO phenomenon. The bottom line here is that over the past several decades, we in the Department of Defense and the intelligence community have been noticing things in our airspace that don't have wings, they don't have cockpits, they don't have even an obvious sign of propulsion like an engine, and yet still they're able to defy the natural effects of Earth's gravity.
In 2020, the Pentagon declassified three videos, the Tic Tac video and two others filmed on the East Coast in January of 2015. Other countries have made similar public disclosures. Also in 2004, the Mexican Air Force confirmed this video was shot by one of their pilots near the coast of Baja California.
This is what you were talking about earlier, the Mexican Air Force.
Just as a reminder to the audience, we just talked about the two different ways that the ancient Vimanas would camouflage themselves. One was to make themselves dark and unseen, and another one was to take the glow through a mirror and through the wind and the electronic disturbance at the front of the Vimana and project that glow around the craft to camouflage itself also. That's all we see in these government released videos.
Yeah.
Exactly those two descriptions.
In 2014, the helicopter from the Chilean Navy locked onto an unidentified object emitting what appeared to be some sort of gas or vapor. Both governments have said they investigated but couldn't determine what the objects were.
Looks like a chemtrail.
Those like science writer Sarah Scholes, clipped black and white videos always leave a lot to the imagination.
Mm-hmm. To me, the most interesting thing about the videos is how little information is in them. All we have are these, you know, 30 seconds or a minute of something totally decontextualized. And so everybody kind of gets to think whatever they want to think about them because we don't actually have enough information to form any kind of conclusion, which is UFO's favorite space to live in, the muddy, fuzzy space.
But will 2021 be the year all of that changes because of COVID-19?
Hidden among the many pages of the COVID-19 bill is this mandate to produce a report on unidentified aerial phenomena. What's different this time is that the military is kind of talking about them very explicitly in terms of threats. It's not like the Pentagon's deal to call things aliens, but that's kind of the angle they're coming from.
If there is a foreign adversary, let's say Russia or China or anybody else, who happens to have this technology and they've had it for decades, and we in the United States have somehow been strategically leapfrogged in our technology, we've got a big problem on our hands.
Officially, the clause attached to December's COVID-19 relief bill, added by the Senate Intelligence Committee, calls for the military and FBI to brief committee members on what they know about UAPs within 180 days of the bill's passing, the kind of top-level briefings Elizondo says he's given before.
The three options are, is it our technology? Is it foreign adversarial technology or someone else's technology, or is it something completely different? We're 99% sure it's not foreign adversarial technology, so that only leaves really one other option. It's someone or something else.
Are these three videos the only videos that you know of that the United States government has that shows unidentified aerial phenomena?
No, absolutely not. These are probably some of the least compelling videos. Some cases, you know, we've seen these things 50 feet away from the cockpit.
And when you're talking about something that is 50 feet away, I mean, what could they tell from being 50 feet away?
With all due respect, Gotti, I no longer work for the United States government in that capacity. So I want to be clear that I don't want to speak on behalf of the U.S. government. And I also want to give the government time to do what it needs to do regarding this data.
But basically, I mean, I can't answer or I'll die.
Yeah, right.
I'll let them answer that question. I can't anymore.
Are we going to see in the same video?
Extraordinary
that same guy, I'm pretty sure, was saying that he was told that they know what they are. They're demonic.
It's not in this video.
I'm pretty sure it was that same guy, though, wasn't it?
Yeah.
This is NBC, man. Unfortunately, this is not going to be that full testimony. They've clipped a bunch of people's testimonies.
Yeah.
But in science, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence.
If the UFO field wants to be taken more seriously by scientists, I think they will kind of have to move away from the types of evidence that have historically been held up as adequate, like individual sightings, because the scientists can't really do anything with the story. They need data.
You guys see that? Mm-hmm. There's the triangle ones. All right. Mm-hmm. So here is the ancient Vedic text on the left-hand side about one of the Vimana shapes. And then there's sightings of triangle UFOs as well, even down to the same Mercury engine containers in the corners of the triangle shape UAP. These are ancient Vimanas, guys. They're not from outer space. They're not from another planet. They're not from Alpha Centauri. These are not interdimensional. They're literally ancient tech that's been reimagined by the governments of the world in connection with unclean spirits, in connection with the demonic forces of the world. This is the same information they've always had, but there's an agenda. There's a reason why they're bringing this out to the forefront now, because they've got a bigger game afoot.
No,
the final card.
Yeah,
that's right. And so we've been hearing from other testimonies of people on the inside as well, talking about how these kinds of technologies, these kinds of concepts will play out in a deception that will affect the grid.
That's right. Oh, I think we lost West Place.
Is he talking about the lady
and the scale, the masses? And so, yeah.
Oh, hey, buddy, are you back?
Yeah, Carol.
Yeah, okay. You want to set that up real quick again? We lost half of that.
No worries. I was just saying that there have been a lot of people throughout history that have been talking about that these same technologies, these same ideas and concepts will play out in a greater deception that will happen here on the masses in the end times. And so Miss Carol Rosen is one of them.
Yeah. She tells us all about it.
Good morning. My name is Carol Rosen. In 1974, I was introduced to the late Dr. Wernher von Braun in the U.S., the father of rocketry. In my first meeting with him during that first 3.5 hours, he said to me, "Carol, you will stop the weaponization of space." He said, "No, you have to understand. And we have to prevent the weaponization of space because there is a lie being told to everyone that the weaponization of space is now first being based upon the evil empire, the Russians. There are many enemies," he said, "against whom we're going to build this space-based weapon system, the first of whom was the Russians, which was existing at that time."
The strategy that Wernher von Braun taught me was that first the Russians are going to be considered to be the enemy. In fact, when I met him in 74, they were the enemy.
Headlines around the world echoed the news. Russia had blasted a man-made moon into outer space. On every continent and in every land, the story of Sputnik 1 dominated the front pages.
Then there would be terrorists. Then there would be third world countries. Now we call them rogue nations or nations of concern. Then terrorists would be identified, and that was soon to follow. We heard a lot about terrorism.
Global terrorism.
Terrorism. Terrorism.
Terrorism.
Terrorism.
The evil terrorists.
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 Then we were going to identify third world country crazies. We now call them nations of concern. But he said that would be the third enemy against whom we would be needing to build space-based weapons. Then there would be asteroids. And the next enemy was asteroids.
This new one you're tracking, a
How big?
It's what we call a global killer. Nothing would survive, not even bacteria.
If I had any say in the matter, I'd say, why don't you throw in asteroid defense?
An asteroid some scientists call a city killer came closer to Earth than the moon this week. The scary thing is that scientists had no idea it was coming.
Now at this point, he kind of chuckled the first time he said it. Asteroids against asteroids were going to build space-based weapons. So it was funny then.
And then he would repeat to me over and over, the last card would be the extraterrestrial threat.
What he called aliens, extraterrestrials, that would be the final card. And over and over and over, during the 4 years that I knew him and was giving his speeches for him, he would bring up that last card. And remember, Carol, the last card is the alien card. We're going to have to build space-based weapons against aliens. And all of it, he said, is a lie. The way he said it to me, there was no doubt in my mind that he knew something that he was too afraid to talk about.
In other words, we have to have some reason to spend these trillions, to waste these dollars on a space-based weapon system, and they're all lies. This is a system, he told me, that would never protect anyone. Even back then, he talked about suitcase bombs. He talked about chemical, viral, bacterial, biological warfare that these space-based weapons would never protect us against.
A new service branch of the U.S. military within the Department of the Air Force. President Trump first announced the new Space Force in 2018, and its creation was made official with Space Policy Directive 4 in February 2019. The Space Force officially came into existence on December 20th, 2019, when the National Defense Authorization Act, NDAA, guaranteeing its funding, was signed into law.
Very importantly, I'm hereby directing the Department of Defense and Pentagon to immediately begin the process necessary to establish a Space Force as the sixth branch of the armed forces. That's a big statement.
Because space is the world's newest warfighting domain.
Space is a warfighting domain.
The next warfighting domain.
Space is a warfighting domain.
I said, oh my Lord, this man is telling the truth. And I've been waiting until this day for 27 years, and I'm expecting the spin to happen, because he also explained to me, as a military strategist, as a person who worked on the MX missile, which I did later, he said, you will find that there is going to be a spin to find some enemy against whom we have to build space-based weapons, and now we should expect the spin.
I couldn't help but say to him, just think how easy his task and mine might be in these meetings that we held, if suddenly there was a threat to this world from some other species, from another planet, outside in the universe. We'd forget all the little local differences that we have between our countries, and we would find out once and for all that we really are all human beings here on this earth together.
In our obsession with antagonisms of the moment, we often forget how much unites all the members of humanity. Perhaps we need some outside universal threat to make us recognize this common bond. I occasionally think how quickly our differences worldwide would vanish if we were facing an alien threat from outside this world.
Because he said part of the formula for the intelligence community is if they might have a weapon, then we have to consider that they do have these weapons. So now they do have these weapons, so now we have to build these weapon systems. And that's the formula, except that it's all based on a lie. And these are words that Wernher von Braun told me in 1974, and I will testify before the Congress under oath about everything I have said and more.
What do we know? We know now we live in an ever-expanding universe. We know that there are billions of stars and planets literally out there, and the universe is getting bigger. We know from our fancy telescopes that just in the last 2 years, more than 20 planets have been identified outside our solar system that seem to be far enough away from their suns and dense enough that they might be able to support some form of life. So it makes it increasingly less likely that we're alone.
Oh, you're trying to give me a hint that there are aliens.
No, I'm trying to tell you I don't know.
Oh, you're trying to give me a hint that there are aliens.
No, I'm trying to tell you I don't know.
Oh.
But if we were visited someday, I wouldn't be surprised. I just hope that it's not like Independence Day.
Yeah, right.
Movie, that it's, a conflict.
Well, now we have friends.
Maybe the only way to unite this incredibly divided world of ours. They're out there. We better think of how all the differences among people on Earth would seem small if we felt threatened by a space invader. That's the whole theory of independence.
You're right. You're
Everybody
right.
Everybody gets together and makes nice. And
in my line of work, you got to keep repeating things over and over and over again for the truth to sink in, to kind of catapult the propaganda.
Crazy, crazy, crazy. We had a question in the chat. Did you happen to see it by chance, Sean? You're muted, brother.
I did not see a question.
I'm going to put it up right now. It was Miss Madeline Scroggs watching our show. Shout out, Miss Madeline. Thank you. Well, she asks, why can some people see demons, evil spirits, but not angels? I know some people have shared stories of them seeing angels, but they're rare compared to demons. And that would seem to fit with what we've heard a lot in testimonies from individuals that they, you know, demonic activity is a lot more prevalent than stories of people knowing for sure that they were interacting with angels. So I'm thinking of a verse, Hebrews 1, in verses 13 through 14, we're comparing here. Paul is talking about how that Jesus was made higher than the angels. To which of the angels has he ever said, verse 13, Hebrews 1, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet? And then he goes on to say, are they not all ministering spirits sent out to render service for the sake of those who will inherit salvation? So there's that verse. And what would you say about that, Sean? How is that applicable?
Well, basically, this is the Father's promise to us that he's got. And by the way, Psalms and other passages tells us that there are myriads upon myriads, which translates from the Hebrew to the English as being millions upon millions of angels that he does have for this service to send out to us, your inheritance, to mankind, right? So these are his servants that he's, since creation, since the beginning, he's always had these guys to send out to us. We see all kinds of stories in Scripture. There's lots of testimony from people, but the problem is personal testimony, unless it's codified in a book and other people believe what's written in the book, personal testimony becomes personal testimony, right?
Hearsay, myth.
Just like the personal testimony you have of people seeing demons.
Yeah.
You have to just choose what you want to believe, but there's just as many, I would say, more people that have claimed to have seen angels and personal testimony than demons.
But really? Okay.
I mean, because I've heard there's entire YouTube channels dedicated to people that claim they've seen angels.
There are. Yeah, you're right.
Well, it might also have something to do with the minority of Christianity as opposed to the world. And if that says our sin is ministering spirits to those unto salvation, that sounds like only God's people are going to have these encounters with or people that are going to, convert or whatever.
Most likely. And, yeah.
Yeah.
Think about Daniel. I think it's Daniel chapter 4. When the pagan kings are taking some of the temple artifacts and they're having this big party, and then the handwriting shows up on the wall, right?
Yeah, that's right.
They got to see an angel, but it wasn't a good experience for them.
I know. I was just about to say, unbelievers all too often don't have pleasant experiences with the hosts of heaven. But there is another verse that comes to mind here, and it's Hebrews 13, starting in verse 1. Really, verse 2 is the focus, continue in brotherly love. And do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for by so doing, some people have entertained angels without knowing it. Angels unawares, other translations say. So we know that we talked about earlier that they can assume any form. All too often in Scripture, we see time and time again that they appear as men and that there's no distinguishing them from, you know, a regular man versus a spiritual entity.
That's so right. That would be another good point then, because angel, God's angels are going to be most likely just looking human, whereas deceptive angels are going to appear as something else. And somebody's like, oh, I saw a demon because I saw something monstrous, something alien or whatever. But yeah, the good angels are more probably unaware.
Yeah, and that's the difference in the messenger, right? The demons want to scare you. They want to antagonize you. They want to do bad things to you. They want to lead you into deception. Like we read earlier from 1 Enoch 15, they want to oppress, attack, destroy. The Father's angels, the good servants of heaven that come to help those who inherit in salvation, they're humble. They don't show up in trying to do evil to you or to trick you or to bring fear upon you. They want to bring good to you. And oftentimes, that means they're not going to announce who they are. They're just going to do good to you.
Yeah, and so they're not going to exalt themselves and present themselves as something that you should, you know,
because because they want you to worship the Father. They're not trying to lead you away from the Father, and they're not braggadocious. They're humble. They're full of the Spirit. So here's an example in Judges chapter 13 of Samson's parents who have an encounter with an angel, and the wife goes to tell the husband, Manoah, that she saw an angel of God. She's like, oh, the woman ran quickly to tell her husband, behold, the man who came to me the other day has reappeared.
The man.
Yeah, the man, right? So if you read the rest of the story, we don't have time right now, but if you go into Judges 13, you read the rest of the story, you find out that after it's over, they realize they saw an angel of God, and they were starkly afraid. And they're like, oh my gosh, we saw the angel of God and we lived. Mm-hmm. They were surprised in a sense, not realizing who they were dealing with the whole time. So what a wonderful, wonderful thing, right, is to see the Father when he sends his messengers, these ministering servants, that they're there to help you, even if that means they don't have to astound you or amaze you or distract you mm-hmm. by telling you who they are. Because sometimes just that alone, you can miss the blessing they're trying to accomplish for you because you're so distracted, not really with that situation. What you see Samson's parents and how they reacted, he's trying to do something with them during that story. Go back and read the story, right? He's trying to actually accomplish something. That's why he's sent.
Yeah. Focus on the message, not the messenger. Yeah.
Right. So like if they were so distracted and trying to like, oh my gosh, should we worship this guy? What do we do? Like if they ran and tell their friends and family and then a big crowd showed up, he might not have got to accomplish the whole purpose of his mission. So the point is the Father deals in a different way, and he's not going to come to scare you or leave a lasting impression of horror. You may be dealing with his servants, or you may already have dealt with his servants and not even known it. And that's the beautiful part of our Father, is he wants to help you, even if it means remaining nameless and without credit, because he does that all the day long anyway. So of course his servants would behave in the same way.
Yeah. I'd imagine they can even be invisible doing things to help mankind.
Yeah.
Nobody is even aware that it was even there.
We even see this same example with Yeshua. Like we talked about earlier in the broadcast, when Yeshua got his resurrection body, just like the promise of Luke 20:36 and 2 Baruch 51:8-11, is that when we get this resurrection body, we'll have the capability of angels. We'll be made like the angels in their form. What we see angels can do, we start seeing Yeshua doing after his resurrection.
Yep.
So he gets that resurrection body, and then suddenly he just is eating with two of his disciples in Luke 24, spends the whole day teaching them the word, and then goes to break bread with them, and then disappears right before their eyes.
That's right.
They didn't recognize him that entire time they're walking with him to Emmaus and then go into their house and prepare food.
The same with Mary when she's at the tomb. What did you do with his body?
Yeah, she thinks he's the gardener. She doesn't even recognize him until he draws her attention and reveals, no, I'm risen, I'm him. So it's like, and then what happens to her, right? She changes focus. He has to be like, don't touch me. I haven't said to my father yet. Go back and tell the other. He has to like get her back on track because she's so astounded. You know what I'm saying? So like, if that's not in the mission plan, if the mission plan isn't to astound you, just to help you, well, they're just going to help you.
Yeah.
You know,
that was a good answer for you.
Absolutely. They're not seeking vainglory. That's wickedness. You know what I'm saying? So they're humble servants. So, real quick, guys, that was a wonderful question, by the way.
Yeah.
But I know we're here at 2 hours and 10 minutes. I just wanted to preface just real quick this idea. What is the huge narrative of what we've seen? We heard the guy being interviewed on the NBC report saying they're not little green men, right? They're something else. But what we talked about earlier about where did unclean spirits come from, whom we see being referred to in Ephesians chapter 6 as these principalities of darkness and spiritual high places. And what are these things? Where do they come from? Well, we see, Satan, we know where he comes from. And then the unclean spirits, we know where they come from. So then, all right, they're the ones that we're having to deal with and interact with. We see the perpetration of deception coordinated with the nations of the earth by building this ancient tech, bringing it back into play, trying to deceive us to think that these are coming from a different cosmology, different from what the Creator describes. But is this the only time they've ever interacted with mankind? So what we've talked about tonight, 4,000 years ago, Nephilim interacting with mankind to deceive them. Modern day,
reemergence of Nephilim tech plus Nephilim theology to deceive mankind. What about in the middle? What about all that time in the middle? What's going on there? Well, guys, did you know that there's tons and tons and tons of stories all throughout history about people interacting with creatures that they can't explain, that seem to have powers that they can't justify, that they can't reckon, that seem magical, that they directly call these creatures spirit beings. So a lot of people may have known this already, but I've got Chickasaw and Cherokee in me, so I'm part Native. We have lots of legends, right?
Yeah.
A lot of the civilized tribes in the United States, they, you know, even though, you know, the government kind of labeled this idea, the reason why they call them the five civilized tribes was because these were the major tribes that were the most dominant with trade with each other, as well as they actually had their own alphabet and language, and they could read and write and stuff like that. And they had established territories for the most part. They weren't entirely nomadic. By the time they started dealing with the English settlers. So the Choctaw, one of the five civilized tribes, they have their stories of what they call the little people of the woods.
Like gnomes?
That's what other people call them.
Trolls?
Other nations would call them leprechauns or gnomes or trolls. But the Choctaws call them little people because they resembled half creature, half person. That's straight up Nephilim talk right there.
Right.
Lived in the woods, came occasionally to kidnap kids, and then would give the kids either poison or would teach them proper medicine. And the ones that reacted, they gave them this little wisdom test, and the kids that reacted the right way, they would then train them in the shaman ways of medicine.
Wow.
So that they then were important in the tribe to know how to heal the diseases of the tribe. And of course, they're not attributing any of this to the creator. They're not attributing any of this to the great spirit, which is what other tribes would call them, the great one spirit. But specifically, the Choctaw, and if anyone's out there is watching, guys, and you have Choctaw background, this is not a slant against you. Mm-hmm. This was little creatures, according to the Choctaws, that lived in the woods. And other Indian tribes had the same stories, even all the way up to Michigan. I can't remember the tribe that lived up there, but even all the way across the mid and the northeast of the United States, in Massachusetts, they had the same story of these little creatures that were 2 to 3 feet tall. They looked like humans, but they were very different. Some of them had horns.
Mm.
And they would come in to steal children and give them poison or teach them proper medicines, depending on whatever circumstance they were doing. And some of them actually would, you know, draw them to, they look like chimeras, some like part animal, part deer, some part man, but they're always like 2 to 3 feet tall. What are these little green men always depicted as?
Hmm.
So here's where it gets crazy, guys. This is an ancient Choctaw legend and shared by many, many native tribes in the North America. They also had quote unquote magical powers to where they could heal you of stuff or they could cause trickery. And there's an actual word they call them the Bopli. I think I'm saying this right. Let me look it up again.
It's really reminiscent almost of a retelling, a Native American retelling of the Krampus situation. They come for kids. They either reward them in a way, or they.
I was thinking of Pan as well. Pan had horns, was half human, half creature, and messed with children.
Yeah, the biggest correlation I see in this is just the idea of what they could do versus their description, right? So pre-flood and post-flood leading up to approximately, you know, 1500, even up to the supposedly, according to Roman Emperor Maximus, he fought giants in Britannica, which would be modern day England, in the year zero, 2000 years ago. So pre-flood, post-flood, all the way up to 2000 years ago, you still have clans of giants going everywhere. I've talked about giants before. The ancient Native Americans, like the Chickasaws, we called the giants the Lofas, and there were nomadic, cannibalistic giant clans that the good Native Americans fought against in North America before English settlement came. So that's the big stuff, right? But now what about the little stuff? So think about the strategies of the enemy, okay? Because they're always testing the waters in different ways. So you got, well, they tried giants for thousands of years, realized that, I mean, the slingshot will take one down. It doesn't matter how big you are, right? That's like a sniper rifle. So what do we do now? Well, we'll stay with the trickery. Let's stay with teaching them, enticing them into bad theology. And this is what the little people stories were all about.
Yeah.
Was that these things would live in the woods. They would kidnap children and then either kill them or teach them this type of medicine. So this is exactly the type of, you know, what do we read earlier about the gods giving the information through Vimanas and higher tech in order to save people, mm-hmm. right? They do this both through technology and through medicine. This is like the huge, I mean, I've even heard UFO theorists talk about this. So if the aliens show up, they'll probably help us cure all our diseases. Yep. Like I shared that testimony with you earlier about the guy and his cancer. So think about this. These guys are these little forest dwellers. They're also considered, it's translated as thrower. It's this word, Bopoli. It's also the Kawi Anakasha, which means one who stays in the woods and throws sticks at you. So these guys were sometimes considered antagonists because the adults would hardly ever see them because they would stay in the shadows of the woods and antagonize them from the outskirts of the woods and then go abduct children occasionally.
Oh, interesting.
They also, in more severe cases in the Northeast, could possess people.
Wow. Yeah. That's absolutely guys, demonic.
We're talking Nephilim through and through and through here. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a shared, now these are going to be called legends by mainstream education because they want to minimize any actual information from what's not approved state-funded education. So
they'll call God a legend as well. So.
Exactly right. So this type of story is shared by not just a lot of Native Americans, but by all types of people all across the world about these little people who could disappear just suddenly they could shape shift. They always were interested in kids and stealing kids. This is the biggest red flag. This is occult behavior. Mm-hmm. Right. And so anyway, the point is like, there's all these stories. I don't have time to get into much more of them, but I don't have any graphics to show anybody because we're already at like 2 hours and 17 minutes. I'm trying to shorten everything I'm saying. All I'm saying is guys, different types of deception has been around from the same bad guys that Paul's talking about in Ephesians 6 throughout all cultures and all generations. Nothing's new under the sun, guys. Nothing's
really
not going to be a worldwide deception.
Yeah. So interesting that it's children and like abductions, like an alien abduction, like we hear, and that they would have to do with
four
kids
miracles.
Because all too often we hear children referring to, you know, invisible imaginary friends.
Oh yeah.
And I've had personal experiences with young kids that I was even helping to raise at times that would very much absolutely be convinced that they were looking at something. They would be talking about something in detail that they would see that was invisible to me. So it's fascinating that you would hear of these legends so-called that were these demonic entities would have heavy prevalence with children.
Yeah, and Anita Vega's in the chat. She says that here in Michigan we have Indian tribes that worship Yahweh, like 12 of them. Yes, sister, absolutely. And again, don't get me wrong. Again, what I'm telling about is a legend that the tribes interact with. There were good tribes, there were bad tribes. Okay.
Yeah.
I've talked before about the Chickasaws and the Cherokees, how they found artifacts within those settlements that literally had the Ten Commandments written on them.
Keeping so, feasts.
And they're keeping the feast days, and they've got cultural traditions that 100% match up with Torah and Deuteronomy. There were good tribes. There are not bad. There were bad tribes. They warred against each other depending on what's going on.
These
little people I've been referring to, I'm not saying that these were produced by any of these tribes. These were encounters that the tribes, multiple tribes, interacted with and had to deal with. And it had the same, what's the word? The same semblance, the same outcome, the same details of the story as we're seeing pushed on us with this alien agenda of little men, possibly from a place that's magical. You don't understand. They were, by the way, guys, they literally called the Choctaws literally called these little people spirit beings. That not humans that were just small. They called them spirit beings.
Yeah.
So this is exactly what Enoch calls them.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, the point is, this was what people had to deal with. And in dealing with them, it's the same, even though they're not coming from the sky, they were coming from the woods. It's the same types of interactions, the same types of deceptions. So yeah, there's lots of tribes all over the world that were worshiping Yahweh that we've never heard about. We'll find out in heaven. It's going to be beautiful.
Amen.
Yeah. When that kingdom comes, his will be done.
That's right. But
guys, we've talked about so much. I've been, man, this is so much information that has been presented tonight. It's been more exciting
than a lot of stuff we've been doing.
Yeah.
I appreciate this.
I hope so many people have been edified by it. Just be aware, be knowledgeable about the things we're presenting. Go and do your own studies if you'd like, so that you know that the history shows that this is nothing new, that it's been something we've encountered in the past, that we've been being prepared for through propagation of propaganda in the media, shoved down our throats at every angle. And then that, be aware of the scriptures, be aware of the creation model that we've been painstakingly going over in the show, all these episodes, we're going to continue to do so. Share this information with your friends and family so that they too won't be deceived into thinking that if crafts show up and they're on the news and beings get out of them and that they're here to do any kind of leading or so-called helping humanity, that it's not of the Most High. It's not of the Creator. It's not in our best interests. And the government and what they support rarely has been. That's so right. We love you and we want you to know the truth. And we thank y'all for checking out everything we're presenting.
I'm not saying that if aliens show up, I mean, I would say if aliens show up and they want to help you cure your cancer, I would be like, you know, do you, who's the Creator of heaven and earth, and see what they say.
Right.
Test those spirits. And I laugh at myself thinking like, why would I give that litmus test to aliens, but not to the hospital down the street? Cause they're feeding me poison too. So like, what's
really though? Yeah.
Just straight ask them the same beings.
Ask those beings, who is Lord? Just say the words. Yeah. Jesus is Lord. Just say it. Can you say it? You can't. Why not?
Oh, it's crazy. Mikey, what's going on with you, brother? Tell us about your channel. Let me show people how they can find your channel, your personal channel. We know that you're with Little Light Studios, but tell us about your personal channel.
Excellent. Okay, I do have a personal channel, Truth to the Youth. I don't get to do much on it because I'm full-time dad, full-time ministry, but you can find content on this topic, aliens and a bunch of other biblical stuff. But yeah, man, I love hanging out with Wes Blaze and Sean, and I'm always learning new stuff on here, man. It's always a great talks we have. But yeah, you see the aliens all over this.
Yeah, scroll down a little bit. Scroll down some, Sean. Get that top one off there.
So yeah, if you guys want to see a presentation I did on aliens, there's one right there just 5 days ago. So
cool.
Nice.
Looks nice.
This was a lot more in depth than this stuff I learned about, you know, the ancient technology and stuff, man, that's new to me. I learned a lot.
I'm glad you got to join us, brother. We'd love to have you come back again in the future, talk more about your personal testimony for sure, because we want to hear more from you, brother. And I think other people do too. So y'all check him out on Truth to the Youth. You see how it's spelled there with the number 2 THA Youth. And then also, if y'all would subscribe to Little Light Studios, you're going to find so much awesome content on there where these guys just break down. If you would explain it real quick, Mikey, y'all look at Hollywood and the Gnostic Gospels that they preach.
Yeah, Little Light Studios started about 12 years ago, and the founder worked in Hollywood for 10 years, and then God opened his eyes to seeing that nearly every Hollywood movie has a Gnostic gospel in there, which just means basically an inversion of the Bible. All the villains in most movies have these attributes of God, and all the heroes have attributes of Satan. For example, in the Endgame, you got Thanos, who's sitting on a throne out there in the heavens, and he lives in a ship called the Sanctuary, and he's coming to Earth to destroy half of humanity. If I were just to give you that description, you'd say, oh, that's Jesus. He's coming back. And in that movie, all the mutants, all the, you know, the abominations of the world band together to fight against him. And that's exactly what Revelation talks about, is that Satan's going to deceive a number like the sands of the sea to battle against the coming of Christ. And once you see the template, you cannot unsee it. You'll see it over and over. The Truman Show, you know, the Gnostic Gospels teach that Lucifer, or the being that people associate with Lucifer, was trying to free Adam and Eve from this prison that God had them in. And he was saying, if you eat this fruit, it'll free your mind and you'll be free. And that's exactly what you see in the Truman Show. He was in this perfect world, and there was a guy on the moon named Christoph and Moses. And when he reached the dome, there was a stairway to darkness. And right as he was about to walk out, the man in the moon said, why are you going out there? Like, I have a perfect world for you right here. There's nothing but pain and misery out there. And as he steps out the doorway, the entire watching world applauds. And this is the message we get over and over, to go against the rules, to follow your heart. This is the message that Disney spreads. So we have a lot of that on our channel, as well as exposing the New Age movement, which is huge with this whole alien thing. And so we just like to tackle a lot of tough topics that the church doesn't touch on, but that the youth of this age are really having to deal with and struggle with.
Y'all do an amazing job. You really do, brother. Keep up the great work. Thank you. Thank you, sir. It's really special to me that you got to join us. You've been a friend to me for a while, brother. I really enjoyed getting to meet you at FEIC 19. Hanging out with you was awesome. It was a good time. And this takes me back to when I did a show, for some who might not be aware, if you were to search back on my old videos that are on my channel, you'll find the Geocentric Eccentric old podcast that I did. And on the very first episode, Sean, I interviewed Mr. Mikey Jenny, but he was a follow-up to another gentleman. You remember doing that with me, Sean? Mikey?
Yeah.
Remember doing that episode?
I loved it, man.
It was fun, dude. I like getting to hear your testimony. Y'all can go check out episode one of that to hear some more of Mikey's testimony from a couple years ago. But also on that same episode, Sean and I interviewed a guy named Nate Wolf, who has a channel called Fired for Truth. And so next week, he has agreed to join us to give his testimony, share a little bit about his story of what has happened here to him in the recent years, and where he's come from, where he's at with it now. So we have a little teaser for next week's episode before we say goodbye.
Ladies and gentlemen, Nate Wolf.
Hey guys, it's Nate Wolf.
This is Pastor Nate Wolf.
I'm Nate Wolf.
If you've heard the news about Pastor Nate Wolf,
yesterday I spent 2 hours emptying out my office at the church.
I got fired from a ministry position that I had for about 7.5 years.
Because we lost most of our close friends.
I was fired for doing nothing more but attending the Take on the World 18 conference. Not for speaking out on any truths that I've come to, not for sharing anything on Facebook, not for causing any trouble whatsoever, but simply attending the most amazing conference that I have ever been to. I want to encourage those in ministry who maybe have experienced the same thing, or maybe you're afraid. Maybe right now you're watching this and you're thinking, man, this could be me next. But I'm gonna tell you, and when I share my testimony, that being fired yesterday was probably the greatest thing that has ever happened to me in my life.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah indeed.
Wow.
That's Nate Wolf.
About that, man.
You like the little trailer for it?
I like it.
He said it was cool too. I sent it to him today. So y'all be sure to join us for next week. If you would, check out the Patreon. If you like what we're doing, you want to see us do it better, you want to see more of it, subscribe to us, help support what we're doing so that we can do it better. And we look forward to seeing everybody next week. Nate Wolf, if you're watching, I love you, dude. Check you out next time. Liz and Chris Bailey, if y'all are watching, hit me up, man. I might want to have y'all say what's up next time as well. And we look forward to having a big announcement as well, Sean, won't we? Next week.
That's right. Next week, big announcement.
Big announcement coming up. That's right. Have we got anything else in closing?
Yeah, just in closing, we're going to play a song as we end the show tonight. And the song is from our brother Ken Heidebreck. This is his channel where he's going to be uploading this music. His album drops on Friday, the 11th. And it's called Mountains Into the Sea. Go subscribe to his channel so you get notified when his album drops on Friday. Do not miss it. West Blaze, I got nothing else. Mikey, it's great to have you on. We're going to end the show with one of his songs real quick. So let me just pull that up.
I love you guys. Bless God. May he bless you. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. We appreciate you guys.
glory.